All right, welcome back to the stream. I'm gonna do all my usual pre-flight checks here and make sure all the bits are flowing, but we should be live on the usual places. That's the scanlime-in-progress channel on YouTube, twitch.tv/scanlime, and live.diode.zone/scanlime if you want to get the bits straight from the zone where they're being encoded. Yeah, it looks like we're going. I've also got chat available. Right now I'm just using the kind of built-in chat on YouTube or Twitch, so I'll try to keep an eye on both of those. But hello, welcome back. We're trying a bit of a different format this time, so I'm gonna continue with the project that I've been doing kind of recently, which is at the low level, it's sort of this intense kind of Rust operating systems-y sort of thing, but at the higher level, it's more of a, you know, how do we make it easier to do decentralized video and for us each to kind of host our stuff without having to rely on the monopolies to do it for us. And so I want to get into both of those sides of this, the really low level side and also the really high level side. And in addition to me and Tuco, we've actually got another guest on stream. This is my friend Z, currently inhabiting this sentient System 7 trash can.
Hey, folks.
And I was going to start out just kind of chill, you know, going through some of the code, just, you know, as folks trickle in. But then we've got a bit more of a structured introduction to the high level parts of this. And some of the motivation behind this is I do spend a lot of time just in the weeds poking at the code, but that actually comes from a place that's maybe a bit easier to, you know, to share widely this sort of deep burnout and frustration with the way tech has gone in the past, you know, especially 10 years or so. And so, you know, trying to channel some of that energy into providing alternatives to the giant monopoly powers and trying to meet people where they are, but also make some tools that are forward-looking. So trying to head toward that direction.
Do you think that count is accurate? It says like 15, 13 people on Twitch.
Yeah, it's probably pretty accurate for that one platform, for Twitch, yeah.
But it was like seconds. It was like very quick.
Yeah. Yeah, you're all good at this. Welcome. Oh, that's a really open-ended question. IndoX80 on YouTube asks what our opinion is on free speech and big tech and the way things are going on now. It is pretty open-ended. I feel like free speech is also kind of a loaded term because it both means something very concretely useful, but it's also something that a lot of people use to excuse behavior that ends up resulting in mass violence. So there's like a light side and a dark side to that.
I mean, it's basically content moderation like we've been talking about.
Yeah, that's true. Like, I mean, we'll get more into this later, but I feel like a lot of why the current sort of crop of large sort of content purveyors online are not really serving the interests of individuals or society anymore is kind of related to the scale of content moderation they're approaching. You know, we're no longer creating these reasonably sized communities of humans that are all interacting with each other and sort of applying social pressures to each other, but we're expected to all exist in sort of one gigantic system that's ruled from a central place, which doesn't seem like it ever works out too well.
I keep using the analogy of like, imagine if everyone tried to go to the same nightclub. It was called Walmart Nightclub. And like some people would be like, the lights are too bright. And other people would be like, the lights are too dim. And other people would hate the music. And other people would love the music. And the root problem is that everyone is trying to go to the same nightclub, which is just not going to work.
Yeah, one size fits nobody. Yeah. Yeah, but it's interesting, like, thinking about things from the, like, free speech / content moderation point of view. Like, that's kind of especially poignant looking at, like, what people are already doing with these smaller social media sites like PeerTube and all the various Twitter alternatives like Mastodon and all the right wing ones, and so like some people are getting off the big tech because, you know, they want to create something, and some people are getting off the big tech because, like, oh, you can't tell me what to do, and there's this like mixture of motives in there too. Oh gosh, so last time we left this on sort of like a deep in the weeds, like inner piece of this project. So I mentioned there's sort of a larger goal to do like decentralizing the internet, and then like a slightly smaller goal of, well, let's just make a good way to host video. So like there's already, that's not the screen I wanted. There's already a video site that I've been running for a while. So some of you might be familiar with PeerTube as a open source project, or maybe even particularly Diode Zone, which is my instance of it. But the idea behind this is it's sort of like a content management system for video, or like a video server. It's a thing that hosts video that has a web interface. The thing that makes PeerTube kind of unique, and that's, you know, why they have the peer in their name, is that it's supposed to be a server that you can link up with other servers, and you can sort of share content indexing. You can also kind of, to some extent, share bandwidth and, get other servers and even users to sort of help share the load of video distribution. So I've got all my old streams on here, but it's also just an open server right now that folks can post their own stuff on. And one thing that I really like about this is that it's not a single central instance, but it's a system for creating instances. That feels pretty crucial to me, that it's like a way that people can set up their own space with their own rules. There's even kind of like a template that they have for individual instances where it kind of asks you to fill out like, oh, who are you? How do you pay for this, et cetera? Like, so that people can individually specify like, well, these are the parameters of my particular place I'm trying to make on the internet for people to host video. You can sort of open or lock down registrations to various degrees and customize it to different amounts. But you can also connect these servers to each other. So for example, most of these videos are local on this server, but I do actually federate with a couple of other servers, so sometimes you see videos from other servers. And you can see these videos on other PeerTube servers. So it's got like a pretty good way to try to help like spread out the content hosting and discoverability with other server operators. But, you know, of course it's got plenty of its own problems. Like it's a relatively immature technology, and the peer part of it could work a lot better. The actual video storage parts of it could work better. So I've also been interested, in addition to just like running this to get a sense of what it's like currently and to provide a place for people to host their videos that isn't, you know, one of the big monopolies and is more of like a little community. You know, in addition to just trying this out, I wanted to try to sort of work on something that might be just like a more solid base of infrastructure to put that on top of. And I guess this comes from sort of a longstanding tension. Like as soon as I started running PeerTube, I was both interested in PeerTube and feeling like I just want to change a bunch of things and kind of make this my own. And then looking closer at the source code, it's not the most motivating platform necessarily to work on. It's like, I'm glad that it's there, but I haven't found it to be like as nice to work on as I would like. And I haven't been impressed with, for example, the way that it stores and transcodes video. So while I'm happy to run it and I want to sort of do my part to tell people about it and improve it, I'm also interested in exploring, well, what is the space for making something that works with PeerTube but is maybe better at doing live video streaming and better at transcoding into multiple formats without using tons of extra disk space, and maybe better at supporting like multiple formats of video simultaneously. So that kind of led to some more experimentation. Yeah. So I this is the server, some of the server logs for, or some of the graphs for the server behind my PeerTube instance. One of the motivations is always to kind of keep the disk usage under control. Because right now, PeerTube is not amazingly efficient at the way it stores video. Part of that is because it has to be able to serve video immediately in many different resolutions. You know, if you switch the video from 1080p to 240p, it can't do that transcode on the fly. It's got to already have that file sitting on disk, so that takes up more space. And it also has multiple container formats that it tries to be compatible with, for sort of the WebTorrent flavor of PeerTube and the HTTP live stream flavor of YouTube. And so that adds more overhead. So I started this experiment to see if maybe a different storage strategy based on doing kind of content addressable storage of those individual chunks of video, and then sending those to, for example, IPFS, to a cluster of servers. That might have some advantages in being able to just sort of add new servers to the cluster and replicate things more easily without that being sort of tied to the representation of videos. You have sort of a separate way of saying, here's a blob of binary data that I want help sharing, and then we can layer a video system on top of that. So we're sort of trying to experiment with that. This kind of turned into sort of a proof of concept that can publish video on a kind of live / VOD, like sort of after the fact basis. It can do those both kind of simultaneously and release manifests every, you know, minute or so with the latest video so far in your stream to IPFS. So I was working on this and realized that it would be really useful if we could make kind of strong-ish guarantees about the reproducibility of transcoded video. So if you could have that, you know, original 1080p video come into the server and then downsample it to 240p and save that, and then maybe you realize that that 240p video is easy enough to recreate in real time that you don't need to spend the hard disk space on it, but you need to be able to generate those exact same bits for the content addressing to work, then it seemed like it would be useful to do the transcoding in some sort of a container where you're using like a versioned binary of FFmpeg to do the transcode. That also seems like it would have some security benefits. You know, every additional layer of isolation between the media codec and the rest of your application is useful when media codecs are complicated, error-prone pieces of software written in C usually. So then that led to sort of another nested project, which I just recently sort of published a new version that's not actually usable, but is maybe more of an interesting kind of conversation piece for fellow Rust developers, at least. I'm calling this Bandsox. It is a tiny sandbox that is something that you can just import as a library in your Rust program. So the idea is that the video server, you'd want that to be pretty easy to deploy. Just throw that in a Docker image or on your shared hosting of whatever sort, and not necessarily need, you know, root on a machine or like a privileged Docker container on a machine to just be able to deploy it wherever. But then inside that video server, it would want to have these small, even lower privileged nested containers for doing video transcoding. And that wasn't really easy to do with the currently available technology that I could find. The closest thing I could find was Podman or maybe gVisor. Both of those are, so like Podman is not actually a container runtime. It's more of like the infrastructure around the container runtime. So kind of taking the same place as something like Docker. And it's nice because it doesn't require this background daemon. It is something that you can, to some extent, run at a lower privilege, but that doesn't really solve the fact that like all of these existing kind of Docker flavored runtimes that I could find required the kernel namespaces as one of the layers in their security isolation. They required that to create a new, like a new mount namespace, a new process ID namespace that they could then spawn the containers into. So then there is actually a way to kind of you know, I started talking about this online and somebody came up with an experimental patch to get gVisor to sort of do this. But by that time, I'd already decided I was interested in experimenting with doing this kind of more from scratch. And it seemed like maybe a promising approach to this would be to make a pretty basic like system call filter sort of thing in Rust. So this is effectively like a seccomp system call filter, very similar in architecture to what, say, your web browser is doing internally to protect the rest of the browser from the process that's running your sort of less trusted JavaScript code. Similar to that idea, Linux has this facility that's been built in for a while called seccomp, or secure computing, that lets you just make a filter that restricts which system calls, like which operating system operations an application is allowed to invoke. So this is mostly a seccomp filter, but the issue with that is that once you've filtered things out, nothing's going to work, because, you know, let's say you want to have a virtual file system, you can't allow the application to directly call open in the kernel, because open expects a path in the real file system. There isn't a secure way to just replace that path and then invoke the real kernel's open. So you pretty much just have to implement that open call yourself in terms of something else. So the way gVisor does this is it would implement that open kind of completely from scratch, like in this sort of emulation of Linux that's written in Go. We do something a little bit like that in Bandsox. There's this tracer written in Rust that has the ability to interpose between system calls and the real kernel, you know, interpose between the application and the real kernel on a per system call basis. But it does a mix of kind of the gVisor approach and the more like kind of system call firewall approach, where some system calls like read and write go directly through. Other system calls like open and exec turn into some kind of emulated operation, which is then implemented in terms of system calls that are allowed. So in this case, if you tried to open a file, it would actually trap that. You know, there would be no real kernel open at any point, but the tracer, which is also running under this seccomp filter, would intercept that open, send a request over to another process and like ask for access to the file from the virtual file system, and then it would just get a file handle like back in the mail, like over an inter-process communication channel. So that's the basic architecture. We were getting pretty into the weeds on this on the last stream, working on just how to do remote system calls. So in the context of this process that we're like emulating slash tracing, running a system call like on its behalf and then coming back to the tracer and like repeating that process. And I was getting stuck on the fact that, at least as far as I can tell, getting from the state of like trapping on a system call to trapping on another system call requires taking a trip into user space and then back out of user space. So I had to figure out how to make a brief trip into user space when we might be like replacing all of user space. We might have unmapped the entire program. If we're emulating something like exec, we're replacing all the memory in one program with a different program. So, I found the kind of a weird solution to that though. I'm using one of the existing system calls in this memory segment that always stays mapped, that happens to be used for things like getting the current time from the kernel quickly. It's called the VDSO, or the Virtual Dynamic Shared Object. And so I have this approach that uses an existing system call in there. That kind of solved the problem that I was on last time. So then I made a bunch of additional progress, but I've been kind of putting off showing that on stream because I felt like, oh, nobody's going to want to stare at this crashing in a slightly different way, right? Like that was basically all it was doing for a while, is I was just getting this to give me slightly more elaborate crashes than before. But now I've actually got a test case or a test suite. Like I can run tests. The tests work, and it technically will run a program in the sandbox for very small values of program. Like there are so many things that don't work right now. Like most dynamically linked programs won't work because I'm not invoking the dynamic link interpreter. I think I've got some problems with position-independent code even right now, because I've been trying to work out where some of the crashes are. So, for example, a shell, I've been using BusyBox so far because it's a very simple set of like Unix command line utilities, and it's easy to find already on Docker Hub, and I've also been able to easily just, you know, compile it myself with debug symbols and use that for additional debugging. But so I can, for example, run in my bandsox container BusyBox, the muscle version, which is one of the C libraries that it's compiled with. If I just ran this, I think it would crash because it would try to run the shell, and the shell does not currently work. So signal 11. And yeah, this is all pretty low level. Like, we can debug this by opening this binary in a debugger and trying to figure out what it was doing. I also just recently added a trace mode. So if you turn on the tracing, it'll single step the program instead of only trapping system calls. So it'll give me a big old log of all the instruction pointers that this thread ever hit, which is nicer than not having any idea what it's doing, but it's still not the easiest debugging experience. So this is crashing somewhere that I don't fully understand yet, but it seems to be related to malloc getting an address that is not relocated. I don't know exactly what's going on there yet, but like the kernel, I'm still fuzzy on who exactly does the relocation, but my understanding is the kernel doesn't usually do that. Like, the kernel has some support for relocating modules, but normally relocations are done by the linker. And I think in this case, this program has been statically linked with its dynamic linker, and it is technically a dynamic binary, but without an interpreter. So I don't really know where that leaves this particular relocation problem. So still trying to figure that out. Echo doesn't actually work either. I've been trying to get Hello World working, but this has basically the same problem with a crash basically inside of malloc because it's following a pointer into unrelocated memory. But some things do work, like cat. Look at that. I can do a cat. It totally concatenates standard in to standard out. There's so much of a Rube Goldberg machine in even just having standard in and standard out work at this point. I can cat files from the virtual file system. So like, this is not my actual Etsy shadow. This is the virtual Etsy shadow that I can cat. I can cat multiple files. So some things work. I can do uname. Oh, right. So there's some debug output, which I can silence to make this a little bit less messy. But look at that. It's like a different uname than I get outside the container and everything. So some things are working. I think we had like true and false. Got a whole bit of a test case here going. The goal is to get this running FFmpeg. There's still some more steps to get it running FFmpeg, but you know, LS before you LD. But part of what I was going for here is making the API look a lot like just running a process in Rust. So you can pull a container and give it arguments and run it pretty much as easily as you can run a process normally. So yeah, we've got cat and like, oh, we can sleep. Yeah, basically things that don't involve dynamic linking or memory allocation work right now. So not a ton, but oh man, we can sleep. And so the way this actually looks from the outside is kind of interesting. So while that's sleeping, we can look at the process list. A bunch of this is not relevant, but that's what we're doing right there. So that's the shell that I ran it from. So right now, this bandsox CLI app is just sort of like a quick test harness for running containers. But normally, this would be embedded in some other application. So in my video server use case, that would be the video server. And it would just sort of spawn off these transcoding containers as it needs them. Usually, you know, usually keep like a pool of them running or whatever. So then this sand process is actually a fairly low level thing that's also written in Rust, which does the system call tracing. And then this thing that's just labeled exe is the actual program that's running in the sandbox, which the kernel doesn't know the name of currently because I haven't set it. And then these look a bit weird from the proc tree too. What was that? That was 378.763. Yeah, this is being loaded out of, you can see these mappings are from this weird file in .cache. So one thing that this does is it completely virtualizes the file system. There is no like host kernel version of the file system. File objects themselves are shared between the host kernel and the inside of the sandbox, but all the metadata, all the organization of the files is sort of recreated separately. So in this cache, it's got it's got some temp files, it's got manifests, which are the sort of JSON config files for the image, but then these blobs are mostly the tar files that we've downloaded and uncompressed from the registry. And then these parts are individual sections of those tar files, which we've carved off in order to get separate file objects in Linux. So one of these, for example, is going to be that busybox binary we were just running. One of these is going to be that etc password file or whatever. So every time you access a file, it might have to carve it off into a separate cached component. Because the pieces here aren't necessarily page aligned, so we can't just map them with the virtual memory subsystem. We do actually have to cache a little copy of that. Anyway, so I might go into some more detail about the like deep in the weeds Rust stuff a bit later, but I wanted to kind of bring this back up to kind of the higher level, like why are we even doing this side of things? Maybe get a little bit less technical and a little bit more political, although the two are always intertwined. I hope everybody knows that. So, I mean, anybody who's been following these for a while probably knows that I've been kind of burned out on this sort of techno-optimism for a while. You know, I used to feel more like we would be able to find ways to use this one hammer that we've got to take care of all the nails around us. But that's, I don't know, that I feel that's really fallen flat. Like, you know, the more I grow up and the more I understand just like how diverse people's needs are and how really limited the existing technology is and how much it's just become a tool for all the existing structures of power in the world, like the less it seems like we're actually on the right track, the less it seems like I can just sort of coast on that techno optimism into a future that everyone's going to enjoy, the more it seems like we've actually got to put the brakes on this train and maybe make something that's slightly more intentional. And so, yeah, that kind of led more into this other project that me and my friend Z over here wanted to talk to you about on the stream. It's more of a kind of a, I don't know, just like a realistic look at where we can go from here. You know, I think a lot of folks, I think one thing that Z and I realized that kind of drove us wanting to like put more of this out there, you know, we realized that this was not just like a niche concern. This isn't just some weird thing that I care about because I've been doing this for decades and, you know, that we care about because we're tech nerds or whatever. This is something that affects pretty much everybody. It's just that it's easy to feel powerless about this because the existing solutions are pretty bad and there aren't a lot of people working on solutions that look really viable, and the solutions that might actually be heading in a good direction are often hard to find. So like that's why we wanted to try to do something that's more about the community than the technology necessarily. I think a lot of folks who are in the world of open source software or trying to build new things, like we want to, and like I'm so guilty of this all the time. Like I just want to be a hermit. I want to work on my thing. I want it to be perfect, and I want to release it when it's done, and I want it to be great. But I don't want to like talk to people, and like so many open source developers are like that, and I get it. But it also means that we, a lot of the time, don't distinguish between when something is designed to be like a toy or a resume piece or whatever versus when something's designed to really solve a need that people have. So like I want to be able to kind of shift this stream format a bit so that we can hold space both for the, you know, the little techno minutia things that we all like to burrow into, but also like take a deep breath and actually figure out what people need and try to work towards some realistic solutions and examine like the sort of both the technical and the political forces behind what we're doing. So that's kind of what I hope to get a bit more into with Z here on the stream.
Looking at the comments, I'm curious what Chris is thinking about browsers.
Oh yeah, sorry, I'm a little behind on the stream here.
And there was that comment earlier by INTOX80 about free speech. I'm curious what they had in mind as well.
Yeah, gosh, if you're still around, I would love to hear some more about what you had in mind. Just saw Chris's comment that sharing file handles is harder than it should be. Yes. Yeah, it is pretty annoying.
Why is that?
Oh, it's just this weird corner of Unix that I don't think a lot of people use. So it's like sort of a weird, I don't know. So like everything's a file in Unix, right? Like you can just read or write things like they're files, but there are some like special ways of reading and writing things that give you additional functionality. So if you have a network socket, you can read or write it and like send or receive bytes, send or receive packets. But, there's also like, out of band data where in addition to sending a regular packet, you can send like a special packet that's attached to it. And there's like a whole separate feature in TCP that's used for that. And then this thing, the file handle sharing is actually like a sort of a feature that's kind of like that TCP out of band data, but it's been bolted onto Unix sockets. And it lets you, if you have a Unix socket connection to another process on the same machine, you can send not just like a file number, but like an actual kernel file object. So if you've opened a file and then deleted it and you have an open file handle to it, you can send that handle to another program and it can access that file even though it never opened it and the file doesn't even exist on the disk anymore. Hmm. So like those are the kinds of corners of Unix that this sandbox inhabits. There's actually a Rust library for making that relatively nice that I'm using on the kind of higher level portion of this, but the lower level portion that doesn't use as many libraries, I had to kind of write one of those more from scratch.
So Chris is saying that he builds Firefox from source and it's kind of a hassle or it's hard to keep up with.
Oh gosh. Yeah. I don't think I've ever actually tried that. I used to build a lot more stuff from source than I currently do, but I don't think I've ever done a Firefox build. Oh, that's a good question. Walrus is asking how hard it would be to implement the remote protocol interface for GDB. It's not hard at all. I've implemented that before on microcontrollers. And just for a little context, this is one of the ways that you can implement a debugger, which is kind of like thinking ahead a bit in this project. I don't think I've quite gotten to this, but one of the things that makes this hard is that there isn't a great way of debugging what's going on. Like things pretty much just happen and then you have to figure out, well, why did it just crash? So I think I mentioned that I had a way of tracing all the instructions that run, but having a way of attaching a debugger would also be super useful. And GDB, for anyone who doesn't know, is just a common command line debugger that's existed for a long time as part of the GNU project and kind of ships alongside GCC. And it supports a very simple like serial protocol or like network protocol that you can use to attach to programs running elsewhere. So that's a convenient way of adding debugger support to an environment that doesn't already support debuggers. Yeah, in capitalism, we're all some kind of hypocrite. I mean, basically, I feel like people who take like hypocrisy as a thought terminating, like, or conversation terminating kind of action are just like looking for a way out, right? Because it's like we're all existing under capitalism. We're all supporting like ridiculous, terrible, inhumane systems to varying degrees. And like some of us are better at mitigating that than others, but why bother splitting hairs when we can like talk about how to make the systems better?
So one of the things you said a minute ago was about community versus technology for its own sake and technology in the service of human needs. And I'm curious if you could maybe say a few words about why you started Diode Zone years ago. Like what motivated that? Like, was it more frustration? Was it more like wanting to create a space for people?
Gosh, yeah, that's a good question. And it has actually been kind of years now, hasn't it? It feels like time flies. But yeah, Diode Zone, I feel like I started that partly because I wanted to experiment with what the alternatives were and to like get a sense of, well, what is it actually like trying to run a site that hosts video that isn't one of the big monopolies, and like how can I tinker with PeerTube? Like, what is it like from a technical perspective and a community perspective? But then once I started playing with it and started looking at, you know, what's going on in the decentralized web space and like what are other folks running on PeerTube, it started seeming like there were a diversity of approaches. Like some people were approaching it seemed like trying to move away from YouTube specifically because like, oh, there's something on YouTube that I don't want. I don't want to be like censored in this way, or like my channel got banned. Like, so you see a lot of people who have like this very acute motivation to get off of YouTube or Twitch because they have content that's being specifically censored, or they like feel like, you know, they want an environment where nobody can tell them what to do. And so sometimes, you know, that's really great. Sometimes that's not so great. You see like you see people who are having problems with like music copyrights or like, you know, nudity or whatever, and creating these communities that like exist specifically so that they don't have to deal with that particular problem. But then you also see people who are like, more so than even having a single grievance, their grievance is that they don't have full control. So like the kind of free speech absolutists, they want the control. They don't want anybody to even have the ability to tell them what to do. So then you see a lot of that. So like once I kind of got the lay of the land and saw what people are doing, I was realizing that I wanted to try something that was a little different and wanted to try making something that was more specifically a space for like original content and with kind of a slant to like kind of creative electronic-y stuff. So it seemed to me like I saw some value in an experiment, at least to try to make a specific place for something, you know, not just a place where, oh, no one can tell us what to do, but a place where, you know, oh, this particular kind of thing is especially appreciated and we can try to like make that grow. So yeah, it kind of started as like a tech experiment, like, oh, I want to play with PeerTube and hack on it. But then it turned into this feeling of like wanting to nurture a small community, like a little plant and watch it grow. And I feel like it's really great to have platforms that let you do that. Like that feels like it's been a core feature of the internet forever. Like, you know, starting a bulletin board or something, like starting a forum, like you want to make a little hangout for people to share interests or share like ethics or whatever, and you can make that. And I think there's a lot of value in, you know, I mean, of course, like echo chambers that just like steer people toward extremism are a problem. But I mean, I also think that like just having a single one size fits all like Walmart experience is like pretty bad, and I've been wanting to try to do what I can to fight against that.
I like Ananaut's comment about, like, I don't know, the old school internet was really charming, but Facebook is kind of gross. But going just totally turning back the clock to the point where, you know, the internet is kind of this complicated mystery and it's hard to access. Like, that's not necessarily the answer either.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, no, that's very true. Like, we're not gonna make things better by just, like, wrapping everything in another layer of obscurity. It wasn't, like, in the past, we had this sort of gatekeeping based on the lack of accessibility on the internet. And, you know, it's like when people fetishize, like, pre-Unicode days. It's like, that wasn't actually great for most people. Like, it was simpler to program, for sure. And, you know, computers didn't have as many moving parts, I guess. But, like, a lot of people had to just put up with ASCII or switch code pages or just always be staring at a computer that was written in a language they didn't understand.
So Joel is noticing that this is our first time using Adobe Character Animator.
Yeah, there's definitely some room for improvement there. It's running off of a microphone, which is separate from the ones we're actually using for streaming, and it's not especially selective right now. We were trying to use different approaches, like, you know, sort of face tracking versus mic input. And there's actually, like, a whole complicated lip sync system that I'm not even using right now because it's like a whole separate, like, just like flappy up and down kind of jaw motion that bypasses all of that. So it doesn't have as many options.
So I think to some extent it'll move based on audio, based on our settings, but it can also move based on Micah's audio, and it'll also move just based on my mouth. Even if I'm not speaking, like, hold on. Okay. So it's probably not as lifelike as it could be. So maybe next time we'll have it better.
Yeah. Yeah. There's room for improvement there for sure. Oh yeah. Chris says Unicode is a long, complicated story of politics. Yeah. I wish more people understood it like that. Cause I mean, so many people, especially on YouTube, you know, I'm sure if this stream gets at all popular, I'll have at least a few haters that are like, oh, why are you bringing politics into this? And it's like, dude, politics was always there. You were just ignoring it. Like, your idea of what politics means is very narrow. Maybe you should step outside of that. Does it use NVIDIA CUDA cores? Oh, the character animator? Probably. I think it uses the same library that After Effects uses, so it might have some CUDA acceleration. Oh yeah, Mr. Radar adds that CJK unification was insanely political. Yeah.
I don't know much about that, but my impression was it was like, these are a pretty diverse set of character sets, and the Unicode people were just going to kind of lump them together. Does that match your perception?
I don't actually know the detailed story either. I'm kind of curious about this. I mean, I know that there were, several mutually incompatible ways of representing the same characters, and I think there were some compromises in, like, getting both the technical compatibility guarantees they wanted and also, like, trying to keep the political taxonomy happy.
Yeah, I'm curious what Platypus with Cheese is thinking about with the internet of 1996 being terrible. Not that I disagree.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm always curious about details. Like, certainly don't disagree. Like, gosh, what was everybody using in 96? I don't know if that was when I was using, like, AOL or...
I don't even know if I was on it at that point.
Yeah, I don't remember what year our family actually first, like... I think the first internet access I got was actually an AOL trial CD. Like, I think I got an AOL disc in the mail and convinced my parents to let me try it.
Yeah, I think I might have been on AOL by that point. On, like, a Performa.
Oh, gosh. Sammy is wondering why we're using Rust instead of C++. Why would we want to use C++ when we could use Rust? That's what I'd ask. Oh, an Apple IIc in kindergarten. We might be a similar age. I think my elementary school had Apple IIes and Apple IIcs and stuff like that too. Nineteen ninety-six was dial-up 2856K. Yeah.
Did anybody here play Bolo? It was like an early Mac network tank game. Would have been like circa 1996 or 1999 or something.
I remember we recently tried to get this working in an emulator.
Did we?
Yeah, I think I tried. I think I have a VM image around here somewhere called Mac Bolo that has that running.
Yeah, I think I've seen it on archive.org too.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's where I downloaded it from.
Oh man, Zork.
Oh, Zork.
Do people know about Zork? It was this series of like text-based kind of RPG type adventure games. They were so good. And I didn't like, who was that? Truzito. So that person might've experienced them like the first way. Hmm. I think when I was playing them in the late 90s, it was retro, you know, cause computers had graphics by that point. But it's still nostalgic for me to think about them.
Yeah, gosh, my experience with text adventures was similar. I didn't play them when they were like really new, but I remember like when I was kind of first exploring Linux and like open source applications, I tried like a Zork emulator or like a Z Machine emulator and ran some. I think I got kind of far into playing the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy text adventure. I never beat it, but that was the one I spent the most time with. Sammy is concerned that Rust is in its infancy and prone to change, that it's not stable. And I would add that it's a perfect match for my software, which is also in its infancy and not stable yet. Actually, there are some really nice features in Rust that make this specifically way better than if I was trying to use C++. So, like, statically enforced lifetimes of references in Rust are such a lifesaver. Like, if you've ever tried to write C or C++ code that doesn't use dynamic ref counting or garbage collection and doesn't have memory bugs in it, then you know what a pain it is. And like, it, Rust is no silver bullet, but it gives you some really powerful tools to work toward that. So I really like Rust's borrow checker. I know it's easy to get in fights with, but it's there for your protection, and you'll eventually be friends with it. Also, async Rust, certainly not stable, but it's brilliant. I love async Rust. I'm using it on the kind of high-level parts of this for networking code, and I'm using it in the ptracer for like syscall emulation and everything, so that I can basically have like a lightweight task per emulated process without having any OS threads. It feels like a perfect match. Like, I can have it do basically everything at compile time and just give me a single state machine per task that I can run. So I think Rust is actually a pretty great match for this project. I think I've written enough C++ that I would rather use that for projects that absolutely require it and not start new projects in C++ if I can avoid it. Oh yeah, Joel's wondering if I finished the mods to the house for this channel and how Tuco is. I don't know if I could say finished. I still feel like there's a few odds and ends I need to do. Like, there's a fiber optic cable running across the ceiling that I need to actually run out to the garage properly. And I need to do some more thermal insulation, but it's like mostly good. I've got a giant snake of wire running between this studio and a rack of equipment, and that was most of what I needed. I feel like I've got the studio in pretty good working order these days. I agree with Alexis, who says opinions about the programming languages other people choose to work with are canceled. That's always been my feel, right? Like, if you want to write something in some weird programming language, then more power to you. And the people who also like that weird programming language are going to find it interesting. So, like, right? Especially, I feel like nowadays it's, like, easier to interoperate between languages than it ever has been. Like, more, like, we have more RAM. We don't have to run nearly as many things in the same process anymore. More things are glued together with HTTP. More things need security boundaries anyway. More people are containerizing software. Like, everything is pointing toward it being easy to write code in whatever language you want. So don't let the haters tell you not to use your favorite language. Nice console scripts in PHP. That's not quite my cup of tea, but you do you. Oh, that's interesting. Merlin says GNOME Introspection offers an interesting language agnostic FFI. I assume FFI is foreign function interface. That's pretty cool. It's always nice to be able to, like, kind of take lower level code and, like, script it a little bit. Like, you can kind of do that with Python and C types. Oh, nice. Alexis wants to build a brainfuck interpreter in hardware and use it as machine code. I'm all for, like, weird hardware that is, like, special purpose to running a particular kind of code. I had this dream when I was a kid. I wanted to build, like, a hardware mod music player, like the 4-channel Amiga format. And this was before I was into FPGAs, so I was imagining doing it with, like, logic gates and EEPROMs and stuff. And maybe someday I'll actually do that, because it might still be fun. Well, yeah, I'm glad we're talking about this. I mean, I think most of what we're trying to do at this stage is, like, collect feedback and have conversations. So I'm hoping we can have this be more of, like, a regular format and have frequent conversations with Z and I and all of you, anybody who wants to participate on the internet, with, like, just talking about what works and what doesn't and what you need, and, like, trying to connect the enthusiasm for making things work with the, like, concrete goals.
Yeah, so we kind of have a basic format for big picture conversations, which is basically what currently sucks about technology, which is a pretty target-rich environment. And number two, what's exciting about newer technology or more divergent or more decentralized kinds of technology. And then just getting feedback. I have kind of a design background before I had a technology background. And so I often think about things from, like, a user-centric perspective. And you know, and so I'm interested in hearing, like, what problems people have and what solutions they're using. And so we have some things we can talk about relative to the current tech scene and some new technologies that we've come across recently. But that's kind of the big picture, is, like, wanting to have more high level conversations with people about what they like about technology, what they don't like, and connecting different kinds of people and projects that might be helpful.
Yeah, totally. We even have some visual aids and maybe a bit of a structured way of getting some feedback here. Yeah, would this be a good time to point out the website, see?
Yeah, I mean, we could talk about Facebook. We could talk about I mean, so the big picture question is, like, what about technology is frustrating for people right now? And that could be more of, like, a detail oriented thing, or it could be more of, like, a mega company type thing. It could be about Facebook. It could be about Amazon. There's been some interesting stuff about Facebook in the news recently, which is part of why we're thinking about it, but maybe people don't want to hear about Facebook. Someone says Facebook is an antisocial network.
Yeah. I mean, it was originally like a hot or not site, right? Like lofty ambitions there.
I mean, the thing it's in the news for lately is basically content moderation, which is pretty universal. That was one of the initial questions in the chat about free speech. And so whether it's on Diode Zone, like you're, I mean, you effectively censor content on Diode Zone. Other people experience censorship on other websites. So I think it's a pretty universal concern beyond Facebook.
Yeah. And I mean, like, one person's censorship is another person's, like, you know, spam fighting. So, like, it really depends on having, like, goals that are compatible with the site that you're inhabiting and having, like, enough of a diversity of site operators out there that you can find something like that.
Chris says that the employment landscape in tech is not good for idealists.
That's true. Yeah, it tends to burn folks out if they want to actually try to do some good.
Do you want to say more, Chris? Like what kind of idealism or what kind of perfectionism? So, Station 240 says something, which I've heard this, if I understand correctly, I've heard this from a lot of people.
Oh, yeah.
Which is like, you know, on Twitter or on Instagram or something, you're like, oh, check out this channel, which is about woodworking pictures of Homer Simpson or something. And I want to receive every item from this feed because it's really important. And you subscribe or you follow. And you actually algorithmically may or may not receive all of that content. It's like you kind of don't have control of your feed really anymore. Am I getting that right?
I like how Twitter even like lets you switch it to the regular timeline, and then they just switch it back without telling you. They try to trick you into enabling more of their algorithm.
I don't know why it's so controversial. Like why? Why can't they just have a vanilla timeline, which is exactly what you subscribe to? And then maybe there's like a more algorithmic timeline, which is weighted in different ways. And if it's better, you can switch to that.
They've got to optimize your engagement, though. It's like about keeping people hooked. I mean, that is like a feature of... social networks that aren't out there to capture maximum engagement, though, is that they are maybe less engaging, so people don't use them as much. But they're like, you know, they're not like junk food as much. They're not actively trying to exploit you.
Yeah. Samir said something about you can be a good programmer or think you're a good programmer without understanding what's going on at the machine level. If I'm understanding correctly.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, Samir says what they hate the most about programming is that you can be an excellent programmer without knowing what's happening in the memory. Yeah, I mean, that's something I've been frustrated about in the past. I feel like that particular frustration for me has mellowed a little bit because it's like hard to draw a line in the sand between like what parts of the computer are you supposed to understand before you can program it and what parts are like okay to not understand. Like there's always more detail there. Like if you've ever tried to make anything from scratch, then like you always have to lie about what you mean by from scratch. Like there is no actual from scratch, right?
Yeah. Is that project we saw the other day?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, quite a lot of things on the internet are like something is made from scratch, but it's made out of something which is roughly the same as what you're trying to produce. Like, like you're making a toaster from scratch out of a toaster.
So concrete says something which I think is arguably true, which is that there may be no good solution to content moderation, at least at scale.
Yeah.
There's been some articles about that. Can't remember the person's name. It's like Mike Minsky. I'm butchering it. But there was someone that had like an article that was like, you can't do content moderation at scale because, you know, no one likes to be moderated. So you're at least annoying some people. You know, it's ultimately a subjective process. And so for some people, banning pictures of mastectomies is good because you're preventing children from seeing nudity. And other people, it's like, this is really harmful. You're preventing people from seeing like the natural body, or you're censoring like cancer prevention photos. Mm. So it's just difficult to moderate any community for millions or billions of people and have everyone be happy about it. And then there's a third point in the article I can't remember. But concrete mentions it's either neural networks or currently at least underpaid outsourced contractors. There's a big issue right now with Facebook's content moderators are mostly outsourced. They're not paid very well. And there's an article I can paste in the chat maybe about how, like, since the pandemic, they've been working remotely, and Facebook has been leaning more heavily, they've said, on their algorithms versus human moderation. And that may be part of why there's been more of a spread of COVID-type misinformation this past year. Mm. And then in response, Facebook is trying to pressure more of the, or there's at least an article that says that from NPR, that Facebook is trying to pressure more of the content moderators back to the office, and some of them are resisting it because there's a risk of getting sick. So we're kind of in a bad situation with content moderation because people need accurate public health information, but we're relying on a janky infrastructure of, you know, neural networks that don't work that well yet and contractors who are underpaid and who are outsourced, and they don't have a lot of status or power in the company.
Gosh. And like, at best case, like, their automated systems, like, all they can do is try to replay their training data, which they've also got us like collect using the same means, like underpaid, traumatized human generating training data for algorithms that try to do the same job but worse.
So Concrete mentioned something that you and I have talked about a bunch, which is it's just really hard to do content moderation at scale. And so part of the problem is just making it smaller. If you have maybe a federation of smaller communities, each of which can do their own moderation, they can also kind of do moderation on each other. You know, like, you can federate with an instance or ban an instance if you don't like how they handle their content. That might be a more human scale approach to the problem versus what we have now on Facebook.
Yeah, I like how we're already seeing that play out on Mastodon with individual, like, Mastodon instances having their own moderation systems, but then also moderating, you know, their federations with other servers, and, you know, having ways of, you know, kind of trying to negotiate where that boundary is between like what you do on a like inter-server basis and an intra-server basis.
I just switched to the tab, which is health workers are actually pretty worried about all the COVID misinformation on social media. And then this one here is an open letter from some of the content moderators recently who are like, please don't make us go back to the office. We're going to get sick. On the other hand, you actually need us because the algorithms by themselves don't do a good enough job.
And they're making money hand over fist right now. Like, all of this has been good for all the tech people at the top, and they're worth more than ever. Yeah, $100 billion. That's not a amount of wealth anybody should have.
It's sort of exponentially, it's like closer to like, or logarithmically, it's closer to a billion, like a trillion than a billion at this point.
Yeah, it's like of the same scale as like, I don't know, like the U.S. defense industry, quote unquote.
So Arden mentioned something else, which is, I think, important, which is like the content moderators, for various reasons, like they just end up having to look at a lot of horrific shit all the time. Pictures of really violent people getting stabbed or killed or decapitated or child abuse. So it's not an easy job. It's a job that people get PTSD from, and it's not like a new concept. Like there's like a long history of like human rights investigators getting secondary PTSD, where, you know, there might be like a war crime somewhere and the people who saw it get PTSD. But then if you're just like watching a YouTube video about it to document it or to do a report about it, you yourself might get PTSD just from watching it. And so there's possibly a need for like a lot more kind of mental health resources for content moderators than they currently get. And I think they talk about that in this letter.
Gosh, I feel like so much of the like what we're being kind of pushed into by the current big technology zeitgeist is just this system where where like there's no possibility to have like close-knit social groups where people have like trust and accountability with each other. It's like they want things to be part of this flat global namespace where there's like one source of truth and one sink for garbage. And, you know, like you don't deal with your own shit like within your community. You like force that onto a single like place where you keep all the underpaid people who have to deal with it.
The Yeti is making an interesting point about, I think, like in this sort of inter-instance Mastodon politics, like losing people. I'm curious if you can say more about that.
Yeah, gosh, that is a tricky problem. I feel like it would be useful if there was something more like a personal Mastodon, not like an instance and not like a browser, but just like something that is yours that maintains like some durable representation of the state of your stuff, like things that you've said that maybe you don't want to be public anymore, but you want to have a personal record of, or like information about who you've had contact with, like stuff that you don't want to be out of your control, but you want to keep a record of. Like, it might be nice to have a program that lets you do that for yourself. But yeah, that's just like more in the direction of like doing things yourself and like kind of power user land. So it is like, we need a way to help people support each other, not helping people be like as independent as possible necessarily.
So people seem to be at least a little bit interested in the content moderation piece. I'm curious if everyone knows about the fact that Facebook now, as of this week, has a Supreme Court, like a quasi nominally independent Supreme Court that's supposed to try to manage like high profile cases of content moderation. It's a pretty weird story. I'm just not sure how widely it's known.
I hadn't really heard about this until Z mentioned it to me.
I feel like I remember hearing about it being maybe kind of in the works years ago. Like it's been talked about for like 2-3 years, but it only actually officially became like a announced thing that is actively doing stuff this week, basically. Like there's a board appointed, and they're dealing with like six cases. So it's just weird. Like there's like 300 million people in the US, and there's like a billion plus people on Facebook. And there's now like a Supreme Court of Facebook, which is sort of like in a certain limited way, like more has like a bigger constituency than the Supreme Court of this country.
And like, are there lower courts also, or is there just a Supreme Court?
So I don't know, but I think that's a great question. So anyways, this is one of the articles about it. I'm going to catch up on the chat. Hold on.
Gosh.
Yeah, someone's saying they thought they did that a long time ago. They probably have had some kind of internal process, but like my impression is like the entire moderation process is very opaque internally. Like the frontline people are not even Facebook employees. They're under like a million non-disclosure agreements probably. And the appeals process, like it's a far cry from how transparent like political court systems in this country tend to be. Not that they're great, but like, I think it's even more opaque with Facebook. So I think this is sort of new. So you see that the timestamp is December 3rd. And yeah, so almost 3 years ago, that was when it was kind of floated. But anyway, so there's this thing now, and these are the first six cases. So it's like, you know, is it legit to like say, you know, French people should be killed for massacres of the past? I don't quite understand the Armenian one. Photographs of breasts on Instagram, which were for like cancer prevention purposes, but included nipples, which are against the policy. A quote by Joseph Goebbels, like, is that, you know, is that more of a historical reference, or is it more of like a hate crime? The way, like, I don't know what the context was. And then you have some COVID misinformation. So, there's a lot of people talking about this. Like, a lot of people are also pretty underwhelmed. Like, they're like, yeah, these cases, like, you know, they're kind of, they'll be interesting, but they could have picked some better cases. And like, we still don't know very much about what leads up to it. And there's a lot of restrictions on what they can do. So I think they can appeal stuff that's been taken down. Like you can appeal to them something that's been taken down, but not something that's been left up.
Hmm.
So I don't know. Like, I think it's very interesting, but it doesn't, to me, let them off the hook, you know? And so you have, let me find it on Twitter. So some other people started in response something they called the real Facebook Oversight Board, which is like, it's like the real Supreme Court.
The real Ghostbusters. Gonna,
yeah, it's the real Ghostbusters. So, for example, I think if they took Steve Bannon down after saying he would behead Tony Fauci, then Steve Bannon could appeal that to the Facebook Supreme Court. But because they didn't take action, there's no possibility, if I have my facts right, about that situation. So they're actually like talking about that, even though like the Facebook Supreme Court can't talk about that. Oof. Does that make sense?
Gosh, I mean, they're Facebook never makes sense, but yeah.
So anyway, so their whole website got taken down for a while for like a trademark violation, even though I don't think that's legal.
Gosh.
But it's back up, and I don't know much about them yet. I just think it's interesting. But it looks like Shoshana Zuboff is involved with them.
Hmm.
And she's pretty interesting. So I think that's worth checking out. And I'm just curious to see like how these cases get decided. like one of the selling points is like, oh, well, even Mark Zuckerberg has to abide by the decisions of the Facebook Supreme Court. Let's see if that sticks, you know, like what if they do something that the exec team doesn't like? So it's an interesting time for content moderation, I think.
Gosh. Yeah, Alexis says that the Facebook could just fire their Supreme Court anytime they want.
Right. I want a recount.
Yeah, I mean, it's very cynical. Like, it kind of reminds me of what was the proposition here? Prop 22, the one that like Uber and DoorDash and all them put in. Like, they want something that has the appearance of regulation while actually not holding them to any meaningful standards.
I'm catching up on the chat as well.
Oh gosh. Chris adds that it might almost make more sense for the actual legal system to be used. I mean, idealistically, if the legal system were less discriminatory. Yeah, I mean, I remember feeling like back in the 90s when this was all newer that like you basically could not trust the court system to make any kind of sensible decisions when technology was involved. And I don't feel like that's significantly changed, but now there are, you know, significantly more like lobbyists on the tech industry side trying to put their thumb on the scale that direction.
So maybe now's a good time to mention the survey.
Yeah, let's point people at the website.
So we made a website which is pretty bare bones, but the main point is to have a survey. And so like there's a lot of cool discussion happening in the chat about people's thoughts about what's working for them about technology, whether that's big technology or smaller technology. I think me and Mike are interested in hearing from people in a slightly more structured way about like, what do you like about technology? What do you not like about technology? Its impact on you as an individual, its impact on society, you know, both in general terms, how it relates to things that you value, maybe about specific things. Maybe it's really focused on like, you know, I really don't like Uber. I really don't like, you know, Amazon Web Services. I don't know. I don't know what it is that gets you going. And then talk about what alternatives have you looked at? So for example, my personal biggest beef is probably with Facebook. I think it's a pretty gross company. And yet, because of network effects, it's actually pretty difficult to keep in touch with your friends if they're all on Facebook or if they're all on Instagram. And so any ways of doing social networking or just peer-to-peer communication outside existing networks is pretty interesting. And yet often when I've tried some of these alternatives, some of them are more janky than others. And if something's kind of janky, it's going to be hard to get your friends to, you know, convince them to join it. So I think we're both curious, like, you know, what concerns do you have? What alternatives have you checked out? How did that go? And then is there any support that me or Micah could add, or anyone else could add, whether that's like documentation or, you know, communication around some topic that you care about. So go to this website, it's defangme.com, and you can just submit a quick, survey that gives us some of your thoughts. And if there's some interesting feedback, we might talk about it on a later stream. Do you have anything to add to that?
No, I mean, yeah, definitely check out defangme.com. There's some more information on the top too. Like I feel like we've already been kind of talking about a lot of this, just like why would you care about this? And a lot of you are probably already on that same page of like kind of for sure a lot of you who have been on the internet as long as I am probably are just frustrated because you've seen a lot of these changes for the worse happen like in real time. But like, you know, if you need a refresher, there's always some links to specifics about what these companies have been doing recently.
So we talked about Facebook. Do people current, like, what are people's thoughts on alternative social media right now? Like Mastodon, for example, other things that we might not know about. I have been trying to be excited about Mastodon, but I don't know a ton of people that are on it. Some of the friends of mine that I mentioned and that I tell about it, like, they're pretty underwhelmed. They're like, oh, this feels like Twitter, you know, circa 2007 or something. So I don't want to be cynical about projects that are new and getting going, but I'm curious what people's thoughts are on social media and on alternatives to the current incumbents. Alexis is slowly drifting Mastodon towards, it looks like.
Yeah, I've been trying to do that too. I feel like I still have to get my Twitter fix frequently, but I've been trying to at least use Mastodon as like a second auxiliary kind of cozier community, and it feels nice. It's also, I mean, it is kind of complicated to get started with, because there is more of a decision to make. It's like you're not just getting on Mastodon, you're getting on a particular server, and there's like some decision making and even some politics around that. So, I mean, I can understand why it's a harder process, and then it's not just like designed to be engaging like Twitter is, and it's like maybe a better place for like weirdos who are interested in having a like weird separate place right now than for people who want something that's like more kind of shiny.
Samir is saying something about like it seems important to have a combination of like good content moderation but also maybe a good user experience. I'm not sure if I got that right, Samir. The Yeti says they switch instances frequently.
Yeah, I keep being on the fence about whether to, you know, hang out on a particular instance or like make my own instance a lot of the time. And I'm on beach.city these days, and it's been pretty cozy, but it's mostly just because, you know, it seems like there are a handful of nice people there, and like, you know, the person who runs the instance seems nice, and it's more about like the little like interpersonal space that creates than the like attributes picked from a list. And so that's more complicated. I don't know. I have a hard time with a lot of that because I am such an introvert, like such a hermit. Like the parts of this that do require interacting more with people one-on-one, like while they might be like better for me and like better for society in the long term, they are actually like harder sometimes than just like pulling up to a faceless server and taking my assigned spot.
So, Dead Drago, what do you mean by missing Tumblr? Like, it still exists, right? Like, is it about the changes that happened a couple years ago? Like, what changed for you?
Did you ever use Tumblr?
Not really. I mean, I had like a little account I used for some things here and there. I had a little Tumblr I ran just with like really ridiculous emails people sent me. But I definitely wasn't like really into it like other people I know are. TDT Record says that if we want to get out of big tech, we need to host our own things, like a Facebook profile or content, and host it from home. And I like kind of agree. Like, I feel like people who can host their own stuff from home should try it out because it's really empowering, but it's also not something everybody can do. And so I feel like ultimately we're going to have to build like cooperative technology where individuals who have resources can use those resources to help their friends out and like share them equitably, hopefully.
So the idea of hosting from home, though, it's not a bad segue to Beaker, though.
Yeah, that's true. We did want to talk about Beaker. They had an exciting release just recently. I think this was this week, right?
Yeah,
they hit 1.0.
So I don't know who knows about Beaker browser or the DAP protocol. Is it HyperCore? Or Hyper something.
Yeah,
else.
they renamed it from DAT to HyperCore.
So the Internet Archive runs periodic meetups on decentralized technology. I think on that website that we just linked you to, there's a link to it. But so me and Mike were at one of the recent ones, and I feel like a lot of the past ones have been more like a discussion, and this one felt a bit more like tech demos. So I don't know if that's a sign that there's like more stuff being released. But there was a quick talk by one of the main people from Beaker Browser, and I don't want to say that I really understand this that well, but I've been paying attention to it for a few years. And it's basically a browser that appears to be based on Firefox. And like you can browse a normal website, but you can also basically publish something from your browser to the DAT protocol, basically. And so in theory, it allows the possibility for, like, you know, you just have a document on your your own computer, on your own home network, and you sort of publish it, and then as long as you send someone the link, they can just get it from your computer. And then there's this other feature, if you Micah, maybe click on the share button on the top right, where, you know, so like suppose Micah is sharing this cat video from our house. Someone else can click that share button and be like, I like this content, I'm going to pin it. So they're like participating now in the resharing of that file. So it doesn't seem like radically different than a lot of peer-to-peer protocols I've heard of, but it always seemed like pretty intuitive. It's like you have a document locally, and then you can share it, and then other people can pin it, and that becomes more accessible on the network. So I just thought it was exciting that they had a release recently. It's been kind of in beta for a long time. And we didn't spend hours trying to get it to work, but we spent maybe like half an hour trying to mess with it. We had a little bit of success.
Yeah, I keep meaning to look in more detail about like what kind of network protocol debugging options are available, because I've had this problem before trying to experiment with Beaker, where it won't connect, and like I can't figure out why. Like I have a pretty locked down firewall here, so there are any number of reasons why maybe it isn't working. But like I've often wanted to have like more visibility into, and this is not just for Beaker, but like peer-to-peer applications in general. Like peer-to-peer networking is hard. There's always going to be a lot of ways in which it can fail or be slow. Like you see this with IPFS too. Some people are like, oh, IPFS is always slow. And like, well, no, it's just sometimes slow, and it doesn't give you good indications about when to expect it to be slow and when to expect it to be fast. But I like what they've done with the kind of browser interface where, you know, you can just create a shared document. And actually one interesting difference between this hyperdrive protocol and IPFS is I've also been playing with IPFS a bunch. I've done some streams on that video project. IPFS is really based on the idea that one of these content hashes that identifies an object on the network, that's just an immutable chunk of data. You know, once you've named it, that name is based on the content hash, and the data never changes. If you want to post something new, you post another blob of data, and you forget about the old one, maybe. Whereas Beaker is really more like designed with versioned objects as a first-class resource. So instead of having to just like, instead of making it someone else's problem to locate the next version of the object when you make a new version of something, the protocol formerly known as DAT, actually every object is like append-only log, where it's a sort of acts like a file system that you can make changes to, and it has revisioning, but it keeps the same name. And I think the name is actually like the public key of the file or something like that, some portion of the key. And so the name is random, but it identifies not a particular piece of content, but a particular kind of thread of content, like a particular permission for appending content. So it's also pretty interesting under the hood. Like the whole thing's written in JavaScript right now. I think someone's working on a Rust implementation, which should be maybe a bit better for like dedicated servers or for running inside WebAssembly. right now, kind of everything is implemented in Node.js, which makes it interesting to hack on, maybe harder to embed in certain cases, but it's an interesting attribute.
So one of the things I found interesting was like, it was a little harder than I thought it would be to get an example of it working. So what did we do? I think I hosted like a static website on my laptop on the network here, and it looked like it worked just purely on my machine. And then I sent Michael the link. It was like a /// link. And even though we're technically on the same network, she couldn't open it. And so maybe there's something unique about our network, or maybe it's like a flaw in the protocol somewhere. So then I went to Twitter and I tried to find a bunch of links of people saying like, oh, check out my Beaker browser website, /// blah, blah, blah. And I opened maybe like 10 or 15 different links and none of them worked. And again, maybe that's a flaw in our network. Maybe it's a flaw in the protocol. Maybe these are just websites that someone put on Twitter for like a week and they just weren't being hosted by the point that, you know, by the time we tried. But this one here is the first website we tried that worked. Do we still have, I think the GitHub is there on the top right.
This one.
Yeah. So someone was like, here's my demo project of a Beaker browser website. You know, the hyperlink is right there. They published this like 10 hours ago and it worked. So this is someone's Svelte app. So I think we know that it at least works.
This looks useful. I hadn't noticed this dat store. That seems like a server-side component that just reserves stuff.
Yeah.
That's cool. Yeah, this might be... I should play with this soon. So yeah, I mean, I have a theory about what's going on in our local network case, which is that I don't think we're technically on the same network subnet, and so if it's trying to use multicast DNS, I don't think that'll actually work, just because my network is weird. I think it's also trying to communicate by doing NAT hole punching, but my firewall also just doesn't like that. So it's weird. I feel like it should be able to make a UDP hole punched connection on this firewall, but I don't know whether it's just not trying to do that or whether it's not succeeding. So it'd be nice to just in general, I mean, you don't want to overwhelm people with information, right? Like you want it to just work. You want people not to have to be network engineers to debug it. But when something goes wrong, it's nice to give people information that they can use to debug it. So I don't know where the balance is there, like not overwhelming people, but also giving enough information.
Samir in the chat is talking about how you want some kind of a balance between you don't want users to post stuff that's too awful. You also don't want the content moderation to be too heavy-handed, which, I mean, I think makes sense. I feel like the heavier you get with content moderation, the more it seems like a newspaper or something that has like a unified point of view. And I don't think that's exactly what people want from like a social network.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like mostly you just need people to be on the same page. Like you need to find like a way to have users and moderators with kind of a similar idea of what the site is for. And maybe, you know, if you have enough users who want something different, they can start their own site.
What is FreeNAS?
TDT? Oh yeah, FreeNAS.
You know about this?
I know about FreeNAS. It's a like a FreeBSD based network storage distro. It's like pretty easy to set up. It runs ZFS. It's like one of the things that I tried out when I was setting up my NAS before just like setting up a regular Debian machine. But it's pretty good. It's like you know, it's designed to be sort of like a appliancey kind of thing that you can install and configure from the web interface, but like you can also hack on it and load plugins and stuff.
So earlier I was asking about people's experience with Tumblr And it seems like, yeah, it seems like when the Verizon acquisition happened, a lot of people left the platform. And I remember a lot of people talking about how Tumblr was like great for adult content. And then once Verizon took over, they kind of shut that all down, or the algorithms got more kind of unreliable. It sounds like some people in the chat are backing that up.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Esten's got an interesting comment or question. He's wondering what my thoughts are on business promotion and like, how do you, where do you draw the line on like, is advertising and commercial content allowed? And yeah, there's probably always going to be a tension between people trying to sell their stuff and people trying to have a non-commercial experience. I mean, I think ideally you can find, a place to put your content where the mods are like cool with what you're doing, but maybe that's not always possible. Like if you are trying to like sell something that nobody actually wants, but I mean, if you're selling, like your stuff, like, you are selling something that a lot of people would probably be fine with having, information and maybe advertisements about on their site. So like if you like find the right audience and aren't too pushy, then I can imagine that that might work. But it does kind of require like a different approach to like respect and boundaries between like a company and their customers than we usually expect. Like we usually just kind of expect that like advertisers are just gonna like piss in the pool wherever they want, and people just have to kind of leave if they don't like the way it feels. And it's, and you know, maybe we can have our own pool where we don't let people just do anything anywhere. So, it's, I feel like it's definitely going to be a point of tension, but maybe it's kind of illuminating. Like it shines a light on what kinds of like content moderation decisions like an individual community will have to make like pretty quickly right out of the gate. TDT Records says advertisements need to go. Yeah, I mean, I mostly feel that way, but like I kind of get what Esden's saying with like people also kind of need to promote their work. So I feel like I've been trying to walk that line with Diode Zone where like, if you're selling something and you post a video about it, I don't really mind that. But like if you're a spammer and you're like trying to boost the search engine rankings of 100 different local businesses from all over the world using the same video template, then I kind of will just delete all your accounts. So a lot of it does depend on context, which is something that you can't get when you increase the scale arbitrarily.
So Chris is saying advertising is a net negative on society. I'm curious if you've come across the Python project, I think it's called ethical ads or ethical advertising, but I think it's similar to some other kind of ad networks that are trying to be less kind of surveillance capitalism and maybe less personalized than Google ads are and Facebook ads are.
This is .org. I think this is what we're thinking about. So these guys host docs for lots of packages, especially Python stuff. What's good in here? Godot engine seems nice. I thought they had their ethical ads thing, but maybe my ad blocker is killing it.
Yeah, you have a pretty aggressive ad blocker.
Yeah. Yeah, that doesn't even disable all of it, so. I have like a browser ad blocker and a DNS ad blocker most of the time. Yeah, I mean, that's the thing though. Like, I mean, I feel like at some level users kind of have to have control over what they are experiencing, or you're just like holding open people's eyelids and beaming content into their heads. Like,
so Wombat is saying the Fediverse seems interesting, but they've never checked it out. We've talked about Mastodon. We talked a little bit about Beaker, which is not technically part of the Fediverse. But I'm curious if there are other decentralized apps or protocols that people are getting into lately.
Aw, Not a Bagel says the stream is really chill. Well, thanks. Thanks for hanging out with us. Yeah, I hope everyone's having a good week so far for folks whose week has started. Station 240 misses the early web ads. I feel like ads were always kind of on this like treadmill of trying to push the envelope as much as possible, though. Like, anybody remember those like really annoying flashing GIF ads, or like, you know, the first crop of ads that had like JavaScript that tried to break outside of the frame that it was allotted? Like, ads were always trying to do whatever they could get away with.
I saw a shout out for Brave browser.
Oh, what do people like about Brave? I find it interesting, but not necessarily in a good way. Like, I'm kind of annoyed at Brave for like breaking things that should work, and I'm kind of annoyed at them for being run by some homophobe jerk, but like, and for having like a crypto pyramid scheme. But other than that, it's probably fine. Gosh, X10 camera ads. Yeah, that was some of the early malvertising, wasn't it?
What was that about?
X10 was this company that made like home automation stuff. Like, I actually had some of their stuff. They had like remote controlled light switches and security cameras and stuff like that. And I thought some of it was cool to hack on like in the 90s. But they were notorious for having these extremely annoying ads that would just, they'd be all over the internet. They'd be like flashing and, use like, they'd really try to sell you on their like really small security cameras, like setting them up as like spy cameras or whatever. And they would just like advertise everywhere. They were super sleazy. So like most people who were online, like too overly online in that period of time, probably remember those. They were also in magazines, I remember. But yeah, the internet ads were the most annoying. You may have already won a free iPad. Yeah, that seemed like it was from a similar era. Yeah, another vote for disliking Brave because of Brendan Eich. Yeah, that's kind of where I'm at. Yeah, that's another thing. I'm pretty much with Alexis on the advertisement that like I'm all for my like fellow small businesses getting the word out about cool things that they've made, but I don't want like Amazon advertising at me. I don't want like Apple and Netflix advertising at me. Like, I don't want the giant monopolies using their position to make themselves an even bigger part of my life. I want to be trying to do something that is like fundamentally more about human-to-human business rather than slurping everything up into one giant pile. Yeah. Gotta Photoshop some bite marks on that garlic, maybe.
So there's some interesting survey responses. I'll just paraphrase one of the responses about support, which is about like, how do you talk to friends and family about like why I relate to this. It's like, why I'm asking for their phone number. Like, it's like, who has people's phone numbers these days unless you're pretty close, you know? Like when I'm asking for someone's phone number, it's often because like, I don't want to have to talk to you via Instagram, you know? And how do you have those conversations with people? I feel a bit frustrated with Signal lately because I used to be pretty excited about them as like a more privacy conscious alternative to, like, what do people use on Android? Like on iOS, it's like, oh, if you're both on iOS, yeah, you have this end-to-end encrypted, theoretically, messaging platform, but it's sort of a walled garden.
People use Signal, Telegram, and WhatsApp mostly on Android.
Yeah, so WhatsApp is Facebook now, right? And so Signal and Telegram. So I like Signal. I like the idea of Signal, but maybe 6 months ago or something, 5 months ago, they started doing this, like, you have to set a PIN, and we're going to force you to re-enter it periodically, because we know better than you about your password manager habits.
Right.
And I'm annoyed at this, but I can let it pass. But I have, I'm not going to name names, but a mutual friend of ours that you know, is like, fuck Signal. Like, it's offensive that they, like this has poor usability now because I can't just use it. They keep, like, locking me out of the app and making me re-enter this thing. Yeah. And I think they're like, oh, we want to make sure you remembered it. And it's like, just like, this is a bad usability idea that should not survive.
Yeah.
Does anyone else know what I'm talking about?
I was annoyed by this. I didn't know anybody else was. We hadn't actually talked about this, but yeah, it's, and like, yeah, man, I have like a standard way of keeping track of passwords, and like, I might as well, like, I mean, I just put everything in there and I don't need a program to harass me about it. Oh, Not a Bagel brings up carrier-related issues on Android. Yeah, that is another thing. All the different carrier-customized versions of Android, like, they probably have some weird chat features built in. I haven't experimented with a ton of those. Yeah, respect the user's consent. I mean, consent and boundaries in general are things that I think the software industry could use more of. Like, there's no incentive in capitalism to respect your customers, really, as long as you can trick them into paying you. But, like, we can try to make something that has loftier goals, maybe.
Alexis, do you know of other places that are doing that? I don't feel like I've come across that personally. The Signal pattern.
Oh, I feel like I've seen it somewhere recently. I want to say it was like Steam or Twitch or something, but I might be remembering it wrong. Thoughts on Telegram? I don't have strong feelings about Telegram. I feel like I haven't looked at it closely enough to have a strong opinion about its security. I've been using it for kind of like unimportant stuff, and it seems okay, but I haven't really given it a thorough test or anything. Authentication is a political problem. Yes, definitely. I mean, especially when people don't want to kind of create an infinite number of new usernames and passwords. Like, I mean, I feel like some of us are in the position of like, oh, we've got a strategy for dealing with passwords and we can just like throw another thing in our password manager and it doesn't matter. We'd rather have it all separate. But then I feel like there's this other approach that a lot of people still use where, you know, they don't have their own password infrastructure. They just want to attach everything to something they already remember. And that's a tough position for non-monopolists to be in. Like, unless you have an actual open authentication infrastructure. Samir adds that ads aren't efficient for companies. I mean, I think that's probably true. Like, there's a lot of room to kind of like lie with statistics when you're an advertising company. You can make the ads seem more effective than they are.
So I always heard Telegram mentioned with Signal, and at least the people I would read would be like, well, I feel more confident about the encryption in Signal than in Telegram. So I see Dadrago in the chat kind of seconding that. I don't know if that's true.
Yeah, I've certainly heard that too. I don't know like the details behind it. And then Arjun says Google has that same pattern where they kind of make you re-enter your password every so often.
It almost seems like an anti-pattern to let people choose their own passwords. Like if part of the problem with passwords is that people reuse them, like shouldn't you just assign a password and it's like, look, put it in your password manager. And if they're like, I don't have one, it's like, well, you're not ready to use our website.
Yeah. Oh, that's interesting. I don't know how that username is. Uncobsny says that for security reasons, they absolutely don't want to be storing anyone's passwords if they're writing a website. So it's a tough position. I would say no one should ever store a password. You should always be like using the best hashing algorithm you can afford. So if you're hashing the passwords properly, you're not really storing them unless, you know, you're using a hash that can be reversed and you're not salting them. So like if you're not doing it very incorrectly, like you can store like bcrypted passwords, for example. You don't even want to store hash ones. Yeah. I mean, that's a bit extreme, but I respect that. I mean, the problem is like if you're outsourcing all of your logins to someone else though, then like do you want, you know, Google's or GitHub's or whatever's login infrastructure to be a core dependency of your site? I mean, some people definitely choose that, but I don't think I would. Marilyn's asking about if there are rainbow tables and similar. That only works if the hashes are not salted, right? So, like, the rainbow table thing is if there is a single well-known hash function that everyone uses, or that a lot of people use, and it's small enough that you can just pre-calculate large portions of it. This was done for MD5 a while ago. You can download some giant chunk of data that will let you reasonably quickly invert an MD5 hash back into some particular small string that might have generated that hash. So you can use that to try to crack passwords, but it's only effective if your passwords are hashed extremely badly. So like if you're using unsalted MD5 maybe, but if you're using salted bcrypt, then there's no way you'd rainbow table that. So, you know, it's just a matter of like knowing how to store passwords securely. You know, but I mean, I guess this is a good point that, this kind of leads into the point that, you know, you can't rely on everyone to implement algorithms correctly. Like you need to have like an ecosystem of components that people can reuse so that maybe instead of relying on Google to do your authentication, you can rely on some well-vetted open source library to, you know, implement the algorithms, but then you're actually in control of the, you know, the storage and the data lifetimes, and you know that you're not going to be like selling access to other parties, and you know that you're not going to have, you know, internal company policies that allow like random employees to access your users' data. You know, you can make those decisions yourself, and maybe some people make them badly, but then, you know, we need, I guess part of this does lead into, you know, if it's going to be sort of a, you know, user beware, everyone kind of is on their own, everyone has to figure out like which services are trustworthy. If we're heading more of a decentralized world, there does need to be more tooling for people to actually understand what might be worth trusting. And so maybe that's a combination of like social tooling, like having community groups of people who can share stuff that works, and then also some kind of technical underpinning, so you don't just end up with people sharing something that they all use and they've heard is cool, but no one's actually tested in detail. Yeah, I feel like trust is a big thing for me in like open source and centralized and decentralized software. There's like a different underpinning of like how you trust a program based on it being like a large entity that you kind of, you know, have like strength in numbers with, like, oh, if Google's doing something shady, they're doing something shady on a large enough scale that, like, well, you've got some other people there with you at least. Versus if you're on this random website run by someone who turns out to be shady, then, like, well, you're completely on your own there. So, yeah, that feels like a difficult problem. That's one reason why I find stuff like Diode Zone and PeerTube like maybe an interesting way to approach this, because, you know, people aren't relying on Diode Zone to store like critical data. People aren't, you know, using, I mean, people shouldn't be using it for anything like extremely important. It's just like an additional kind of social thing, you know. Even like Mastodon, I mean, people might be kind of relying on it more than they would rely on like a video site, like if they're sending each other like direct messages and stuff. So it's maybe like an easy way to experiment with something that people want and that clearly needs a new architecture, but, you know, it doesn't have to be critical infrastructure like someone's encrypted end-to-end chat program. Oh, cool. Saw Ada's comment about having a project they're going to upload to Diode Zone. Congrats.
As in, I'm curious if you can expand on what you just said, if I'm interpreting it correctly. Like, people in tech are pretty pessimistic about things and are trying to make things better in some cases. And people outside tech have already kind of thrown in the towel and they're like, oh yeah, it's all, I'm being spied on constantly, like I just give up, you know. Which might be about priorities or might be about like skill levels or something like that. Am I getting that right? Like it kind of makes me think about health food. Like I think there was a time when food was very scarce, and then there was a time when it was kind of novel that these, you know, large companies or larger companies were producing food that was like more like had higher volume and you know, like sugar used to be very scarce and now it's very plentiful. And then eventually there was more like a health food kind of a movement to have some kind of a balance. I feel like we might be in a phase of that with tech. It's like I can still remember when it was amazing that you could get a Gmail account and it was like free and it just worked. And now it's like, oh, I feel gross about my Gmail account, you know?
Yeah. Gosh. Yeah. The inhabiting that headspace where it felt like, oh, a gigabyte, we've got a free gigabyte. That just feels so nice on this internet that was so tiny. Now we've got a gigabyte of space and now we just got sucked into this terrible thing. Google still is giving people a lot of free storage. Like they keep the original untranscoded version of all the YouTube videos. So I tried to download everything Google has of mine, you know, semi-regularly, and I think it's something like 60 or 70 gigabytes. Or no, I'm off by a power of 10. I think it's like 600 gigabytes.
So Chris just said something I resonate with, which is like people outside of tech don't really feel empowered to do much about it, so they kind of throw in the towel. People inside tech feel like we're fighting alone. And I think that's part of why me and Michael want to talk about this stuff more, is to just kind of build bridges between technologists and users. Not that they're totally separate categories.
Yeah, totally. The loneliness of that is real. I mean, I feel like, and like we aren't, I think pretty much all of us here are some combination of like people who are like into tech and people who use tech, right? So like you wear different hats. Sometimes you don't want to be like designing the thing that you're using. You just want to be using it. And sometimes you want more control. And yeah, if we could feel less isolated while trying to make these things better, I think that's totally what we're trying to do.
Chris also mentioned now would be a good time for a new web browser. Could we maybe switch? Let me try to pull up the tab. Not sure if I'm going to get this right. Yeah, so there's a bunch of different kind of Google alternative websites. This one is by Peter Levels. And I thought this was interesting because it has like Chrome at the top and it's kind of like a Reddit system for voting what browsers you like. So Firefox is at the top. Brave is the next one. Vivaldi I'd never heard of. Curious if anyone's tried Vivaldi. I think it's led by someone who is involved with Opera. So it's not like totally random. Safari, obviously, Opera, Chromium. Is that kind of what you were thinking, Chris, or maybe something more radical? Like, I sometimes feel like there's also like a DuckDuckGo browser. I'm not sure what's up. Does anyone know what's up with that? I feel like there's at least an iOS browser that they have, but I don't really know how different it is, if it's just like Safari plus a ad blocker. But I sometimes wonder, like should the whole concept of a browser be forked into like, you know, like a, what we now call a browser is actually like a entertainment device. And then should there be something that's more like an old school browser, which is more like a document viewer that happens to use HTML?
I do often find myself wanting a document viewer that does not also run programs.
Like, I remember a bunch of people used to be really into running Firefox with the NoScript plugin, but I don't know. Like, has there ever been a browser that was like just self-consciously being like, yeah, we don't do JavaScript. Oh. This is just a document browser.
Yeah, I mean, links. You can still run links.
But I mean, maybe something more graphical, like I don't know, like the if a website uses server-side rendering, you should still be able to get like a modern kind of looking kind of graphical experience and just, you know, just wait for the document to come back instead of doing it all client-side.
I mean, I've seen a handful of like toy browser projects and I've like worked on some stuff kind of like that in the past, but even implementing modern CSS is extremely daunting. But implementing a browser that supports web, like HTML 3.0 and 4.0 kind of standards, like that's like more possible to do from scratch nowadays, but it's still just, it's so complicated. Like even without JavaScript and even without anything interactive, really just the DOM and CSS are so complicated.
So TDT Records said something earlier about, which kind of parallels what I was saying about browsers, which is like, it almost seems like you need two different kinds of devices, like maybe one that's a general purpose computer, and then another one, which is more like a computing appliance that's more kind of idiot proof. And so most of the time I would want the second thing, but then there are other times where I want the first thing, you know, like if I want to call 911, if this is my phone that I'm going out, and I want to be able to call 911 with it and look at maps with it, and I don't need to run like Python scripts on it, I want the appliance. And then if I'm at home and I'm doing something more interesting, I might want the more general purpose kind of technical device.
Yeah, I would, I mean, in an ideal world, I would probably want both of those different kind of device profiles to actually be like isolated virtual machines on the same piece of hardware. and for me to, like, I would want to be able to have access to the administrative layer that both of those run on, but to not need that access on a day-to-day basis so that I could keep that secure from my own applications. And that starts to look more like something like Cubes OS or something like just like doing all your work inside a virtual machine. That's a really interesting point. Esden is wondering if there's time for a modern UI toolkit that's cross-platform enough to give Electron a run for its money. Right? I feel like that's been a root part of this problem, is that there wasn't really, like, there's kind of a vacuum of good cross-platform UI toolkits, and like the web kind of took that over. Like, I mean, who could have done this other than the web? Probably OS vendors. I mean, Microsoft has a bunch of their own toolkits, but they don't have really any incentive to make those interoperable with other OSs, and Apple's kind of in the same boat. And then, you know, Linux, there's just like UI toolkits up the wazoo, but like, who's got critical mass? Like, pretty much just GTK and Qt. And people have so much trouble like pointing their developments in a compatible direction in the open source world.
I feel like what's holding DuckDuckGo back is its really verbose name. I don't know what's going to come up when I do this. Like, do they have the money to buy? Oh my God.
Yeah, this was recent, actually.
What?
Yeah, they got this, like,
they
this
bought
year,
Duck.
I think.
Duck.com? I was about to roast him. So, okay, so they should just become Duck.com, right?
I guess. People know him as DuckDuckGo now.
By people, you mean the minority of people, well, that know about them.
Yeah, that's true.
I mean, how much, it's much more fun to say duck it than like duck, duck, go it, you know?
Right. I feel like I want to change this.
I'm impressed. Wow.
That's better.
So I didn't technically apply to work there, but a few years ago I came very close to. And I was going through the application questions, and one of them was like, what would make the biggest impact? Like, what would make the biggest difference on the search engine? You know, and this was more of like a front end position. So I was like, fuck if I know, you know, like the results suck. Like, that's like years ago, at least, it felt like the results were not that great. So that was probably the biggest thing. And I didn't have a smart answer for that, but like, you know, the fact that it's kind of a goofy long name, I think, is also one of the things holding them back.
Hmm.
So I'm happy for them.
I was thinking about Not a Bagel's comments about having a like a Raspberry Pi based cell phone, and I mean, so the Raspberry Pi is a nice like hackable kind of platform. But I wouldn't really hold it up as like a paragon of openness, because it isn't really that. It's just a thing that happens to run Linux and is pretty easy to get a hold of. But it's not like an especially open platform or anything. It's just like another like Broadcom or what is it? Broadcom or Qualcomm? It's like some big name SoC that you would find in an old cell phone. Yeah, this is a common complaint Alexis has. The Raspberry Pi is not open. Yeah, more people do need to know that. Esden clarifies, it is Broadcom. Yeah, they don't even have an open boot ROM as far, like, last I checked. Like, when you turn on a Raspberry Pi, the first chunks of code that it runs are not open at all. They're just like Broadcom GPU firmware. Yeah, the bootloader and the GPU driver are proprietary, last I checked. Esden says you can't even build your own like Raspberry Pi compatible board because the chips they use are not generally available. So it's like no more open than a cell phone, really, except that it has a good out-of-the-box Linux experience. Yeah. Yeah. Alexa says they're just 100% like taking advantage of and riding on the open source hardware community recognition. Yeah. I mean, they made a really big push to get their stuff out there into the hands of a lot of people. And like, I don't think their intention was ever to make a thing that is like the most pure or the most open. I think they just wanted to make something that was cheap and available. And they did that. But like, people need to realize that has a limited scope. Like, making something cheap and available does not necessarily, like, that's not even necessarily compatible with making it like open and ethical sometimes. Like, they would need to be approaching the supply chain somewhat differently.
Does anyone remember back in the days of landlines, you could get like a landline phone that had like a clear casing so you could see all the electronics?
I had one of those. It was so good. It was one of my favorite things as a kid.
I don't know if this is fair, but it vaguely reminds me of the Raspberry Pi, because it's like, look, you can see what's going on. I mean, you don't really understand what's going on, but like,
you can see the chips. If you point your camera flash at them, you can reboot them, you know, but like, yeah, Esten says that this is kind of like Amazon skimming profits. Just like riding a wave.
Wait, so not a bagel. Have you tried the Pine phone, or are you looking at it? I was debating trying to get a Pine phone or a Purism phone, maybe.
Gosh, I've got mixed feelings about my Pine book at this point. It kind of needs repair.
Mr. Radar, are you talking about the Pine phone?
Oh, I just missed who asked that. Somebody had a question about the bootloader chip in the Teensy. I'm having trouble finding where that was from. Anyway, I feel like that's also an interesting thing. So for anyone who doesn't know, the Teensy is a pretty popular open source hardware project. It's technically got this small piece of it that is intentionally not open in order to discourage cloning. So it's one of those like taxonomic conundrums where if you want to get particular about what is a sandwich and what isn't a sandwich, like you can argue about whether the Teensy is open source or not. But it's a pretty straightforward board for the most part. It's like a microcontroller in a small form factor and a crystal and some power supply stuff. Like, it's pretty much just a standard board for that particular micro. But like, the value adds that Paul has done are really like in the community and in the tooling and providing like good examples. But then like, in addition to all those value adds, he also wanted his own like insurance policy. So he's got a bootloader chip on there that runs code that he doesn't give to anyone. It wouldn't be too hard to make your own version of that bootloader, but it's just like his own little insurance policy. Yeah, I'd be curious what people think about that too, since that's an interesting gray area in open source hardware. Oh, interesting. TDT Records says, I hope in the future we could decentralize cell service. Yeah. There's like this fundamental thing with electromagnetic radiation that like, you need to kind of cooperate with other humans to use it efficiently. So I wonder what that would look like. You know, would you still have some rules that everyone is supposed to follow, like some protocols? How would you, you know, would it be more like ham radio where people are just kind of expected to share the airwaves? Okay, not a bagel was the one who asked about the locked bootloader, sorry. Yeah, Alexa says that it's a shame that we seem to have gotten so used to closed up computers that when someone releases another general purpose one, it gets celebrated as if it's somehow especially open, even though it's basically still the same thing with all NDA documentation. Right? It's like if it's intended to run arbitrary programs, it's an open source device at this point by some definitions. Chris says that Atmel seems to want to push their own debugging interface over JTAG. I was not aware of that. They've got their own like single wire thing, but I think some other chips do JTAG. That's funny. Yeah, there's a link to an interesting Russian board that is a an VLIW chip that emulates x86. See, I would be more interested in reading the source code to that than actually running it at this point. open source auditable firmware from top to bottom. That would be interesting. See, visibility into what's going on with our technology feels like a pretty fundamental problem. Like running a piece of software is a bit like taking a pill or something. Like, you're putting something into your body and then it can just be whatever. Like, you kind of just have to trust that it's not going to be terrible at some point, unless you have your own analytic chemistry lab. And just like running a binary on your computer, you kind of just have to trust that it works, unless you can analyze every byte of it, which no one really can for any sizable program. So there's this trust relationship that we've got to figure out how to navigate. And or we need better tools for inspecting the contents of things. I mean, that's something that we've gotten into a bunch on these streams is, you know, like, the world around you is full of all these things that are trying to stay secret, but, you know, with enough time and some of the right tools, you can extract their secrets and figure out what's actually going on and what actually happens when you push the button. And I like showing people how that's possible, but it's also necessary to keep in mind that it's really resource intensive. Like, engineering is hard, reverse engineering is often even harder, and these things that we're surrounded by are just so complex. You know, there's always going to be more complexity than there is time to understand it. Not a bagel says they eat pills they find on the ground, but never did install Bonsai Buddy. Yeah, I think I stayed away from that one too. I feel like the sketchiest thing I installed during that era was probably Net Zero. If money was less important, theft and secrets would be less. I mean, yes, there is definitely an anti-capitalism undercurrent underneath all of this.
What was Bonsai Buddy?
Oh, it was like what was it even intended to do? I just remember it was like this purple monkey thing that you would install and it would like hang out on your desktop. I think it was some kind of adware, but I don't even remember what it was supposed to do. It was, I think people installed it because it was a novelty and they didn't really care that it was like fucking their shit up. Yeah, Alexis says if we get to a point where everyone's computing device will only run code written by Gooples on, then we'll have a much harder fight to send them back to hell. Yeah, I mean, we need to... It's like, we can't get too stuck in the weeds with just trying to hold on to power for power's sake, but there's really a point to all this where we do need enough control over our own environments in order to keep, like, our lines of communication and our livelihood and everything else from being just completely swallowed. And, like, I mean, yeah, we already basically are in that world. We've just got to figure out how to open a portal back to somewhere else, or not back, but, like, to somewhere else. That's another thing. It's easy to get, like, stuck in nostalgia land and, like, before these monopolists, things were better. And, like, we had different problems then. Like, computers were not nearly as useful to people. They were much harder for people to use. They were much more expensive. They were much less power efficient. They didn't speak languages that people need them to speak. So, I mean, I feel like this is not so much about like trying to restore some past that never was, but it's about like trying to plot a course through this particular horde of monopolies that we're battling and try to find something good on the other side, which may or may not involve computers.
So TDT is talking about the right to repair.
Yeah.
Does anyone know more about John Deere tractors? Because I feel like I've heard about those for years now, how farmers used to be able to repair their own tractors, and it's becoming harder and harder. And it seems like the same dynamic, basically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've heard a bit about the John Deere case. I think it was like a firmware issue. Like, I wonder how many other auto manufacturers are doing that actually, like, not even giving people the tools that they need to service stuff in the field like that.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, Alexis, we all want to hear about tractors. Yeah, and then Chris says people used to fix their own cars, right? Yeah. I mean, I've seen some people on YouTube trying to fix their, like, electric car parts, but it's certainly a lot more complicated, and you need some weird tools sometimes, and they certainly don't want you to get in deep into the parts. Like, if it involves something below circuit board level, they probably don't want you dealing with it. The Yeti has memories of folks at a computer expo in the late 80s, early 90s, of people lining up at an expo to have their RAM modules tested. I didn't know about that, but I've heard the stories about how gas stations used to have vacuum tube testers. I've not seen one of those in the wild, though.
I think everyone's interested in hearing about tractors.
Yeah. Huh. Dad Drago says Microsoft has been putting a big push into helping get people programming. You know, I haven't been super impressed in the like pure drive to just get people to write computer programs, though. It's like, it feels kind of self-serving. It's like Microsoft wants to crank out more programmers that they can hire. And I mean, do they want people to have more agency over their environment, or do they want more worker bees? It seems kind of more like the latter. Surplus army of labor. Yeah, basically. I mean, if you have enough programmers, they can get them cheaper, right? TDT has some old tractors. Is that, yeah, tractors with a K? Makes a bit of a different sound, right? Oh, that's interesting. And Not a Bagel reports that some of their friends, their programmer friends, aren't too curious about how things work in the world of tech, and that's kind of concerning. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it is concerning when people don't ask questions about what is adjacent to the layers in the stack that they're working on. It's like, if you're working on something but you don't know how it affects the people and you don't know how it affects the hardware, then like you're just kind of like floating around in this void where the work you're doing isn't really anchored to anything real. It's just subject to, you know, it could be anything that people would pay you to do, basically, unless it has that kind of anchor. Like, if it's anchored to the technology, then at least you have some like practical constraints, but it may or may not actually be good for anyone, and it might even be actively harmful. And then if it's anchored to some kind of human need, then it's more likely to be useful. TDT likes programming hardware that interfaces to the outside world and has general purpose IOs. And I've always found that kind of helps keep me grounded too. Like, I don't know if other people feel this way, but ever since I was little and I was first learning how to computer, I remember feeling like I kind of had to keep switching back and forth between doing hardware stuff and doing software stuff. Otherwise, I would get too tired of one or the other. Yeah, right. Yeah, Alexa says they don't trust the capitalistic market forces to drive these companies to keep a backdoor open. Yeah, I mean, it's just a matter of time until it's difficult to find a general purpose computer anymore, right? I mean, it's kind of nice that it is like easier than it's ever been to make a thing from some definition of scratch that hits some definition of being a general purpose computer. But it's like hard to tell if any of that's useful, because the bar has been raised so much for what people actually want and what people would find like useful enough to use. Yeah, it feels like some of this is just getting back to like the complexity that we're dealing with right now. Like things are so complicated that how do you manage that as an individual human without like delegating that complexity to something else? Gosh, that's really poignant. Alexis is on fire tonight. She says that we're at a peak right now of accessibility to making these things, and we're approaching entry to a world where nobody remembers why they might want to. Yeah, I often feel like nowadays there's sort of this dichotomy between the experience of using a computer where it's like a tool, where you're like using the computer as a device to help you with some task, versus the computer is this conduit with which someone else is flinging content at your face and you're not in control. Actually, Z and I were talking about this earlier, kind of as maybe the difference between like using a tool and watching TV. And like, sometimes you do just want to relax and like have content thrown at your face hole, but like, having that be the only option is really scary.
Yeah, like people used to think TV was really stupid. It's like you just zone out.
Mm.
And computers, by contrast, are more interactive. And a lot of the most popular apps are starting to approach TV. You know, it's coming full circle.
Yeah, well, we were talking about this recently with TikTok. Like, I don't really use TikTok, but we were like looking at it a little bit, and I was feeling really jarred by all the autoplay video, because I find it really hard to focus on something if there's just like video that's not necessarily something that I asked for, that's just playing all the time. And so this thing where, you know, it's constantly advancing through a slideshow of videos, and you can sort of pause it or whatever, but you're not really in control, like that feels really jarring to me. I think that just means I'm old.
Yeah, so Ada mentions like we're trying to fight capitalism with technology rather than the it's like we're trying to win a political battle with technology, which is sort of doomed.
Yeah.
I think we tried to give a little shout out to that. Like this survey project is mostly about figuring out like how do we practically get off of these apps and so on onto alternatives, because there are a lot of cool alternatives out there. But like, you know, maybe the real answer is legislation. And I think it depends on what we're talking about. Like maybe legislation is necessary for misinformation or for... Like there's actually legislation right now that Apple is lobbying against to try to reduce the amount of forced labor in the supply chain.
Mm.
So that might be like, I don't know how I can affect this through technology, but legislation might help. But then there are other cases where maybe it's more of a technology problem, or it's both.
I mean, and maybe some of the solutions are just like getting into conversations with people who do technology and telling them that actually some of the issues are social and we need to work on that part first. Yeah, I definitely don't want to be in a situation where we're seeing like technology is the one hammer that hits every nail, because like that's just not even the right approach at any level.
Ada, thank you for your contributions.
Yeah, thank you so much. There's a comment here from Raul Jimenez, who asks how they can reduce their dependency on big tech, like at a device level. They have an iPhone and a MacBook for iPhone apps, and it seems like the only alternative is to just switch over to Android, which is Google, and that's bad, or like Lineage OS isn't great. And I mean, yeah, I feel like that's kind of like what we're trying to get into a conversation with. I don't think anybody has like answers about what you should definitely do, but I think we're trying to set up a way to start like connecting people with support and start some conversations. So like we've got a website. If you go to defangme.com, you can fill out this little survey just to give us an idea about like what you're personally feeling as far as like your needs and like what is most important to you, and like kind of how much you feel like kind of fussing with technology versus how much you want something that's like just works for your particular need. But I mean, I guess personally, like I don't have a great answer for that either. Like I've got a bunch of Apple stuff, I've got a bunch of Google stuff. My personal approach has been to just try not to get too invested in any one vendor. So like I've switched completely like my phone operating system every several years, just because like at some point I was like, I've been using an iPhone for too long, I've got to switch to Android. And you know, I try to keep all my data in my own storage as much as possible and do my own encryption. But like, you know, you can't just like make your own phone from scratch these days, at least not in any practical way. I mean, as we've said, the word from scratch is pretty much always a lie. Like you're building it on something else that is basically another version of the same problems you would have if you started with the, you know, the different raw materials. Like if you build a phone out of a phone, or if you build a phone out of a phone development kit, you're basically doing the same thing. You're just occupying a different place in that production line.
I think people are keen into the fact that like there's no silver bullet to any of the problems we're talking about, and I think that's why, as part of why we wanted to start like an ongoing conversation, because like there just isn't going to be, it's not like anyone can be like, oh, we made an app that fixes capitalism or that fixes this or that technological problem. Like they're all interconnected, and it's going to take a long-term focus to make things better, I think.
That's interesting. Chris comments that Lawrence Lessig's book in the mid-90s argued mainly that software imposes constraints on people that can be more powerful than the constraints of law, and that they're comparable in power. That's interesting. That definitely seems to match my experiences of how I've seen like the law and technology kind of fight each other over the decades and like try to compete for power in our lives. TDT Records says they'd love to build a phone. I mean, I think a lot of us would love to build a phone on some level. I think my point is just that, what are you building it out of, and how long does it take, and what is the result? Like, I could go on a whole tangent about that one time I wanted to build a portable computer. Like, I was in high school, and I wanted to build, like, a small thing I could take to class and, like, type papers on. And I went really deep into that, to the point of, like, making circuit boards and writing bootloaders and everything. And it was 4, 5, 6 years of work, something like that. And not even very slightly usable. I learned a lot. I learned so much about building computers, but like you don't get to the finish line. You just learn things. And if you want to get to the finish line, you have to start with something like a Raspberry Pi or a system on chip that someone's already got a board support package for. And then, I mean, you're not that many steps away from just buying the thing that's already completed. If you want some concrete action, like you want a thing that is manufactured more sustainably, or if you want a thing that's more hackable, or if you want a thing that has a particular hardware feature. Like, you've kind of just got to go after that rather than making the decision to just sort of head for optimal purity, because you're not going to get there. Oh, yeah. There's a comment that and Kovzny is writing their own OS kernel for personal edification, but make no pretenses about ever using it. I mean, I feel like that's a really important step in the development of any computer scientist, is to just pick something that you want to learn more about and like write your own version of it. But yeah, it's important to be realistic about what you're trying to accomplish. I certainly had a big head about it. I thought like, this thing that I'm writing is going to be super important. I have to finish it. It's just like, you know, it was just narcissism. It wasn't real. It was just me not having perspective about what I was making. Yeah. That makes a lot of sense. Alexis says that there's a valid short-term goal of having like just more direct control over the things that we like structure our lives around, like the communication channels we use to keep in touch with our friends and family in 2020, the year of our disaster. Yeah. And Foxing Feather adds that they've been experiencing this condition where, you know, their entire communication's been funneled through the internet for much longer than just 2020. And I think a lot of us feel that way too. Like, I certainly had most of my communication with other humans funneled through the internet since probably the late 90s. And I think a lot of folks who are weird and old probably have similar experiences. Not a Bagel insists that innovation is impossible without capitalism. Yeah, open source hardware and software are certainly interesting, and it feels like a good starting point. It doesn't feel like the solution to much. Like, I feel like a bit of a stick in the mud about open source nowadays. Like, I used to be more like, everything needs to be open source is great, like whatever. And now I just feel kind of let down, and like sure, whatever, open source, fine, but it's not going to do any good. You know, it's like less about the copyleft and more about the actual project structures and like how people work on stuff together and how stuff gets funded and how stuff gets motivated.
Cory Doctorow linked to someone recently, I'll have to track it down, who was just talking about like corporations have basically figured out how to extract all the benefits from open source without any of the serious costs. And so it's like, I've heard some people say like, you know, 10, 20 years ago, open source felt like a very outsider movement, and it's completely won. And in a sense, that's true. Like, it's very mainstream now, but it's one maybe not in the way that it was envisioned 10 or 20 years ago.
Open source has become a profit center for Microsoft.
Yeah, basically.
Which is not what any of us wanted. Yeah, I mean, I'm running Microsoft Linux on my Windows machine right now. Yeah, totally. I think Alexis is really on the same track. She says she totally gets my stick in the mud thoughts on open source, but she also feels like there's a place to build from there, and that there's a lot of potential for communalism and learning how to work together in teams outside of the profit motive. Yeah, totally. Like, in hindsight, I think that was a lot of what drew me to open source back when I first got interested in it. I just like didn't know how to filter that away from all the technocratic stuff. They open source the calculator. That is funny. I mean, just helping people design exploits without having to disassemble it themselves, right? Oh, man. Yeah, we could also do with fewer of the, like, kind of open source celebrity types, like the Richard Stallmans and the Linus Torvalds and whatever. Like, I feel like that isn't really helping.
Oops.
Oh, do you want the...
I have to go in a minute, but while we're talking about decentralized stuff, I'm curious if people have thoughts on Matrix or Element. It's one of the big platforms that seems to have a lot of momentum, but I haven't really used it that much.
I keep meaning to set up a thing. So I've been trying various like less conglomerated chat solutions for here. I've been using Gitter for a while. I got kind of annoyed with Gitter just because it seemed like pretty much only folks that already had GitHub accounts were using it because it's annoying to use otherwise. And I tried running a thing with Big Blue Button, which is still, I'm still running it. I'm just not using it that much, but I feel like Matrix is my next, the next one that I want to check out as a chat platform for this show. So yeah, let us know what you think about it. It might be a thing I want to set up for here.
I still feel like there's a lot of decentralized apps that are interesting. And if you compare them to existing incumbents, you get a lot of things that aren't Facebook. Like Mastodon is basically Twitter. Pleroma is basically Twitter. Matrix seems kind of like Slack. Is there one that I'm missing that's more like Facebook? Because I feel like part of why Facebook is so big is that they have certain features that people want, which is why Facebook is a lot bigger than Twitter, you know?
Yeah, wasn't there... What is Diaspora like? Wasn't it supposed to be kind of like Facebook?
Yeah, I guess you nailed it, yeah.
I don't really know enough about it to know why people don't use it more.
Well, so I paid for a Diaspora... Okay, so my biased, not scientific perspective on why people don't use Diaspora... I tried to use it recently. It was a lot harder to find an open instance than Mastodon.
Hmm.
So it seems like the community isn't quite there. I gave up and I paid for a membership somewhere. It was diaspora.eu. And it just seemed gross. It just we've ragged on Mastodon a couple times is like not super impressive. It's not bad, but I feel like it's basically replicating Twitter. Maybe Twitter circa 5 years ago. And Diaspora in 2020 seems like Facebook as of 10 or 15 years ago. Like it just, this is like a minor thing to nitpick at, but like a lot of the fonts were so tiny I couldn't read them, and it just seemed painful to use. So,
maybe designed for 800x600 resolution.
But I mean, it does answer my question. Like I feel like the part of what some people want is not the on alternative social media. It's not the Twitter experience where everything is a fishbowl. It's more like the Facebook experience where things are a bit more of a walled garden. So I don't know. I don't know what else is going on with Diaspora, but that was my impression from trying to check it out a few weeks ago.
Z, you and I a while ago were talking about something about the difference between like the Facebook experience and the Twitter experience. And it almost like the way you were describing it, it almost made me feel like Facebook is sort of like more like an online game experience where there's like stuff to do with your friends. Maybe that's what people are missing, like something that feels modern but like you can hang out on. And maybe that is just gaming platforms. Like, where is the border between like a gaming platform and a social media platform?
Yeah, like I've never really checked out Minecraft. It seems like Minecraft is like a place where people hang out, you know?
Yeah, I should give Minecraft another try. I tried it like years and years ago when it was much younger and I didn't really understand the user interface and I kind of didn't give it much of a chance. But then like kind of recently I got pretty deep into this 3D factory game called Satisfactory. And as I was playing that, I was feeling like, oh, this feels like what I imagined Minecraft would be like, but I've never really played Minecraft. But it seems like maybe they have some similarities. Discord. Yeah, Discord is super popular. I find it kind of hard to use, but I'm kind of curious about other people's idea about Discord. Yeah, I've never played Factorio, but I've heard good things about it. The one I was playing, Satisfactory, is, from what I've seen, kind of like a 3D game rather than a 2D game, but like similar in spirit to Factorio. Like you have conveyor belts and machines that turn one kind of part into a different kind of part, and you can just, it's like a game about colonizing a planet and like stealing all their resources. It's swell. It's just doing human things. Esten says Facebook replaced forums for a lot of people. Yeah, I kind of miss forums. Oh, and then Besom mentions Scuttlebutt, which is also something that I think Z and I had on our minds. Like, we were looking into it recently, and I didn't spend a ton of time on Scuttlebutt. I was having a little bit of trouble with it, but...
Yeah, I don't want to trash talk it too much, because... it's probably just the one client I tried. I think it was Metaverse, maybe. It was an iOS client. And the client itself seemed a bit like a proof of concept. And we had a lot of trouble getting messages to sync. And I don't know if that was the client or the protocol. Again, like similar to the Beaker browser thing.
It was really similar. It's like a vague network issue and there's no tools for debugging it, which is, it's annoying because it's like, I want to help you out with this network connection, but you won't even tell me what stage of the connection it's failing on. So it's kind of hard to debug.
And like this chat is full of people that are pretty technical and pretty motivated. And if we're getting frustrated with like, I'm trying to text my friend, I can't text my friend, and I don't know what's wrong. Like most people have like, 1% or 10% of that amount of motivation to debug it. And so like, it's just hopeless. Like this will never succeed. Like these projects will not succeed if they don't up their game in terms of usability. I don't want to be a downer, but that's how I feel.
A lot of folks have seemed to be reporting good experiences with Discord. I should really give it another try. Like I've used it just sporadically for keeping in touch with friends, but I've mostly found Discord kind of overwhelming visually, like kind of for the same reason I have trouble using TikTok. There's just like too much stuff like flying around the screen all the time. I kind of feel that way with Discord. Like I want something that is trying to be a tool rather than trying to be like a gaming experience in my face, you know? Alexis says they still like IRC. I should get back into IRC. I tried setting up a little IRC server here kind of recently, and I was pleasantly surprised by all the progress in IRC v3, but I still have a problem where I just don't use it enough to like remember to keep the client open on my machine, so it's like kind of hit or miss whether you'll actually find me on IRC at any given time. It's nice to know that I'm not the only one who's called Discord kind of overwhelming. Yeah, I mean, I'm used to programs that have complicated user interfaces, right? It's just, I feel like Discord is not complicated in a way that I find, like, communicative. Like, I don't feel like Discord is trying to communicate with me. I feel like it's just kind of, like, full of noise. And, like, maybe that's the animated icons and stuff, but, like, gosh, there should just be a way to never have animated icons ever. Like if you think a channel or an avatar or something should move when I hover or just like by itself, then just no. That should be a system-wide setting. It would be interesting if there is an unofficial Discord client. Like, I wonder how viable that could be. Yeah, the Yeti says it took a bit of fiddling to make it feel like Discord wasn't constantly trying to battle for their attention. And apparently, if you make your own Discord server, you can turn off all the animation. Yeah, maybe I'll have to look into that. Although, this kind of brings me back to the point where I feel like I could spend time trying to make the like existing monolithic solution fit my needs better, or I could try to set up something else, and that's why I've usually when I reach this point I end up like spending some time fussing with something like Gitter, or you know, maybe I'll fuss with Matrix soon. There are also illegal Discord clients. That's funny. I assume that a Discord server is not actually a server, though, and, like, if you have your own client on your own server, they will still just block it. Oh, shout out to the Caves of Cud Discord. I've heard that's a good place. Yeah, it bugs me that they call it a server, even though it's just, like, a section of their network. Oh yeah, Esden calls it a realm. That kind of makes a little more sense. Do I know Discord is run almost entirely by furries? I mean, that's cool. And then there's something called Mumble, which is like IRC with voice. I have not heard about that. Oh, interesting. Yeah, a couple of folks say that the servers in Discord used to be called guilds. That is kind of funny. Like, they, how much of their code base is MMO themed? Yeah, MUDs would be kind of neat. We should get back to MUDs. And then Esden reports that the Discord realm being bridged to IRC works all right. Yeah, thanks for all the good conversations. It's been nice, nice talking about this with all of you. Oh, that's healthy. Dad Drago says that they weren't really involved with any of the old chat stuff when they were a kid. They were just outside. I mean, that does sound healthier. I don't know about the rest of you, but I was really interested in this as a kid because I had problems. Oh yeah, Esden says I should hang out on Discord more. Yeah, I probably should. I know I'm on the 1bit². I should actually pay attention to that more. Do we have Tuco hanging out? Oops. Let's see if Tuco will be on camera for any length of time. Maybe not. Oh. I gotta get the cat cam set up again. Oh yeah, folks like tech chat hangouts, then Esden does streams pretty regularly too. They've got an electronics company, 1bit². They make some cool stuff, including these little debuggers that implement the GDB protocol internally. Hacks on some great... Whoa! Tuco is knocking over my stash of protest signs over there. Tuco, are you going to march next time? Yeah, I was definitely one of the weird kids on the computer once upon a time. I mean, I had this really weird, isolated childhood, and I didn't really have any healthy influences in my life, so I just had the internet. Gosh, Tuco is so good. He's been really cuddly lately. Ooh. Sorry about the mic bumping. Yeah, gosh, I feel similarly to Alexis, who spent a lot more time making stuff on the computer than chatting on the computer as a kid. Yeah. I got like very slightly into IRC, but I was definitely more on the computer to hang out by myself and write code than to chat with people. And that was, yeah, that's probably mostly just not understanding people and like probably being autistic and probably not having any like human relationship role models in my life that actually worked. Not a bagel says it turns out it's easier to talk to people in text than in person. I have mixed feelings about that. I feel like sometimes it is easier in person nowadays, but I feel like it's definitely less complicated by text, which is what I needed, especially at a certain point. Like, I just needed like less input. Like, being around people in person was always more overwhelming than being around people in text. Yeah, Alexis says it's probably so good that they didn't get anywhere near some of the internet communities that were growing around that time. Yeah, I feel like, yeah, it was just like luck of the draw that I got involved with the communities that I did and that I didn't get involved with others, because it was super random. Gosh, the first time I actually had a like an IRL experience that had significant overlap with my online world was when this one friend of mine from high school and I drove in my dad's... We borrowed my dad's minivan and drove to Texas from Colorado for an anime conference to visit some people that we only knew online. And that was extremely weird at the time. I think that was in like 1998 or something. Oh yeah, Esden says he started using IRC a lot when he finally got flat rate internet. Before that, it was impossible. I vaguely remember having to pay hourly for the internet, and I definitely didn't chat when that was the case. I think there was something about the way I was raised that I thought that, like, I didn't really place much value on communication, so I thought that something like like, oh, a pay telephone, like you're paying just to talk to someone. You'd have to be crazy, right? You know, I didn't really see the inherent value in communication. Yeah, Ezin remembers calling in to download emails and then disconnecting right away. Not a Bagel says that two of their friends met on a yo-yo forum. That's pretty cool. I met a bunch of the people that I knew on IRC for at least a certain period of time, like through this IRC room that I had for this like DIY graphical user interface I was building at the time. Gosh, yeah, communication being hard, that really feels familiar too. Oh, and another person from Colorado. Yeah, I spent pretty much my whole childhood in Colorado. I was technically born in Texas, but I don't really remember much of that. Tuco's coming back. Hey, Tuco, do you want me to hold you? Ah, he is such a baby. Are you purring? He's only slightly purring. Yeah, Colorado is pretty nice. I mean, I'm pretty fond of California these days. I moved from Colorado to California in, what year was that? 2005, and been here since. Feel pretty used to it, but yeah, Colorado's nice. The seasons are good. That's a really good point. Chris mentions that one big advantage of having friends online is that it's a little easier if you have to move your physical position. You don't lose everyone. Indeed. Gosh, I had that a bunch as a kid. I feel like several times, like I didn't make friends easily. And a couple times, you know, I had a friend who I was really close to and then they moved away and then it was just over. Meow. Meow. Tuco, what are you saying? Oh, that's relatable. RPDV says that they feel like they can communicate, but sometimes people don't really understand the words, or it's like they're broadcasting on the wrong frequency or on a different frequency than people are listening. Yeah, I mean, it does seem like those of us who have had complicated gender experiences have also had experiences with interacting with people that are a little less clear because of that. Like, you know, it's hard to figure out how to relate to other people when you don't even know how to relate to yourself. Yeah, I definitely want to slap around my younger self also for just generally making bad decisions. Tuco is sitting right down here. Not on camera, but he should be really. Oh my. I don't know if I can move the camera without Tuco changing his position. Breaking the fourth wall here. more like just breaking my my setup here. Yeah, he's not gonna stay put long enough for that to be worth changing. Did I get it kind of back in position? All right, well, I feel like it's getting a little late. We could keep talking about tech all night probably, but it might also be worth keeping the stream to a reasonable length. It's already been like 3 hours, and it might make it easier for folks to participate if I don't make all the streams the maximum length possible. Oh, Tuco, are you back? I think he wants to hang out outside, or like he wants me to open the door so he can get fresh air. It's a good view of his thumbs. Thumb cat. Tuco, that's so intense. He is such cat baby. Oh, that's cool. Yeah, it's probably nice to have... I feel like I started having more trans friends after I realized I was trans and came out, but I don't think I had a lot of friends who were not just like straight guys back when I thought I was a straight guy. I mean, it almost feels like it was easier to, you know, like finally, like finally moving to an area where I knew a greater variety of people kind of like unlocked a bunch of realizations in myself. Like I didn't have any reference point to realize that it was possible to be trans before. So there wasn't really much space for me to move into. I agree. Alexis says that Tuco's face says that he's constantly trying to find a way to get into trouble. Yeah. He is such a good little boy. Oh, that's a good question. Chris is wondering if I'm streaming on a schedule. I am notoriously bad at actually doing this regularly. I feel like I'm constantly trying to have a schedule and failing at it. But Z and I are trying to figure that out. I think we want to try to do something jointly on a weekly or possibly monthly basis in this format. I also just like streaming my progress on project-y stuff, like whenever it seems interesting. I admit I was feeling kind of self-conscious about that recently, like my project is just crashing and broken and no one wants to see me crash BusyBox in 100 different ways on a stream and just stare at the text editor. But like we can try doing some more of that. I feel a little bit less self-conscious about it now that it actually runs a non-zero number of programs successfully. And we can try to increase that number a little bit. Esden says the schedules are hard. Yes. Yeah, it's so hard. But I feel like they would be helpful. Like a lot of the annoyance in getting the stream started for me, at least, still is not really... I don't know, not really feeling like the process is finite until it's done. Like the process of leading up into a stream feels like it could be arbitrarily complicated, and at some point you just have to say that it's ready to go and make it go. Oh, nice. Esten's got the Glasgow boards almost ready to go out. Yeah, I mean, you gotta have priorities even when you're trying to be on a schedule, huh? Oh, that's cool. Chris would enjoy the BusyBox crashing. Well, I've got plenty of that. I have an unlimited supply of BusyBox crashing at this point. Like, oops. I could also fail to download BusyBo. It's more fun to crash BusyBox, though, than to fail to download BusyBo. Yeah, look at that. Oh, this is a different crash. This is a different BusyBox binary. So I have a test case or a test suite that runs a specific version because I just wanted the test to be stable. But I'm also often lazy and I just write BusyBox on the command line, which doesn't usually get the right version. If I pick the tag muscle that will often get a version, which is roughly what I want. You'll notice these are crashing at different addresses though. So busybox muscle is loading right here. This is not like a real address that it should be loading at. This is just like a temporary address that I chose. But these are different kinds of binaries. Like, I think this is a dynamic or a position independent binary that is being loaded at an address supplied by the kernel. And I'm being the kernel here and giving it a bad address, which is this, just to make it easier to debug for now. But if I run this other binary, I think this is fully static. And these addresses are coming out of the ELF table. And that means this is probably a completely different crash. But when I just run busybox without any tag, I think I just get whatever they most recently uploaded. So it's kind of a random libc, which is usually not what I want for testing. So is this UC libc? It might be UC libc. That gives me the same crash. This is using the default Docker server when you don't specify your own registry server. So it would be just this binary, which they recompile pretty frequently. But yeah, I don't know where UC libc is crashing these days. I've been mostly testing the muscle version. And I think the glibc version won't work because it is expecting a dynamic library interpreter. They all segfault. They just segfault differently. See, this segfaults on a null pointer. This is also one of those projects where there's a constant tension between just trying to do the debugging and trying to make tools to make doing the debugging less bad. Like, when everything's a crash and the crashes are just hex dumps, you know, it would be nice to have more tools for dealing with that. Like, one of the things on my list is it'd be nice if I could do core dumps. Like, actually, could I do core dumps? Like, how does the kernel core dumper work, and how is my current approach to sandboxing interacting with that? Like, I don't even know if core dumps currently break. I assume they probably do, but I haven't looked into that, so I need to do some of that. Oh yeah, so busybox, I've been using that for testing bandsocks, yes, as Chris posits. And that's really just because I need a place to start, and busybox is very simple. Like, I mean, something else I could run is like Alpine, but I think Alpine is dynamically linked, so that would hit a similar problem. So this is a different kind of segfault. This looks like another one of those non-relocated addresses, so this might be more similar to the segfault I was hitting with muscle. My mental model for what's going on here is that each of these programs I'm running has this large set of operations that it relies on, and my emulation/sandbox implementation is missing a bunch of those. So it's kind of like every time you run a program and every version of the sandbox, you're just kind of like smashing them against each other. And if the combination happens to work out, then they'll get a little further. Otherwise, they'll just crash. But yeah, so not everything crashes, but most things crash. I can run some very simple things that happen to not crash. Like, I can run busybox's help screen if I actually escape that command line option correctly. So this is downloading and running busybox and giving me the help screen. And like, yeah, there's a very small list of things that work that I know of, and most of the ones that work reliably I've already made unit tests for so that they don't stop working. So yeah, I mean, I can run uname. Does T work? This is the same address it was crashing on before. So like, a lot of these are probably the same exact crash in malloc, which I haven't debugged yet, but like, you can kind of get an idea of which of the crashes are the same and which of them are different, even if you don't quite know the full cause. And as far as debugging this, most of what I'm doing here is using the register dump. So the instruction pointer is important. It's also useful to have the maps just for context. This is like, where are all the memory segments actually mapped by my loader? Normally these would be mapped by the kernel and the dynamic linker, but in my case, I'm playing the kernel in this role. My program is playing the kernel and doing the elf loading, and then I'm not actually invoking the dynamic linker yet, so we're not seeing anything that's the result of the dynamic linker. These three sections, vvar, vdso, and vsyscall, are coming from the real kernel, but everything else here is stuff that I've added. This segment right here is that the stack? I think that's just the stack. Yeah. It's just one page right now, but it'll grow as necessary. Sometimes there's a page allocated close to that memory region, like in the same neighborhood as the stack, which is used as a temporary page by the emulator, but that's not mapped right now. It just unmaps and maps frequently because it's not used very much. And so when it does get used, we just map it temporarily and then unmap it. And then all the rest of these are dynamic sections from the binary. So then the other thing I often need when I'm debugging this is I'd like to have a copy of the program that this is trying to run. So the lazy way that I've often been doing that is just to delete my local cache. Specifically the parts directory in the cache. And then if I run this again, then that'll be populated with just this binary. So that is the section of the tar file that corresponds to the actual elf binary. So I could run readelf on that. I could load it in GDB. I could load it in Binary Ninja Cloud, which is kind of cool. I've been getting a decent amount of use out of this program or this recently. This is basically the same analysis engine that Binary Ninja has, but it's running in a web browser and everything's public so that they can run it for free. So is this the right binary? Oh, this is the unstripped version. So this is also why, like, I feel like working on this, I've been dealing with so many different versions of BusyBox. Because actually what I really want is one that I have the symbols for, so that when I'm, you know, poking around in these crash dumps, I actually have a little bit of context. So I compiled one locally. It's in my Docker images somewhere. Yeah. And so this is going to be an example of running an image that isn't on the main registry. So I compiled this image myself, I tagged it, and then I pushed it to my own local Docker repository here, which is this fishbowl 5000. So I could give this to Bansox, but Bansox is actually going to refuse to run this because it's insecure. Insecure manifest. This is an HTTP server, and there's no content hash, so anybody could just man in the middle of this and have us run whatever code. So it's actually going to make me give it the SHA hash. So if I ask Docker for more information about that image, one of the things it gives me is this full name, which includes the hash. So now it'll download the image over HTTP from this local repository, but it'll also verify it using this SHA hash. Forgetting how to use my own program. There is no run. All options are run. Yeah, so now we're hitting this. This is not a mapped address. I don't really know what's going on here, but it looks kind of like an unrelocated address. Like this could have been something valid, but without this, like, you know, 1000 or, you know, one, not 1000, but we need better names for binary constants. This is one with eight zeros. This is a binary 32-bit unit in 64-bit space. What do you call this? I want a name that's like a million, but is like a binary unit. Anyway, one of those. It is one of those earlier than it seems like it should be in the address space. So, you know, one question is, well, like, how did the instruction pointer get down there? Did we call a bad function pointer? Is there like a relocation that's missing? It looks like a missing relocation, but whose job is it to do the relocations here? I think the relocations are done by the loader that's compiled into this binary, but I don't really know for sure. So that's kind of the stage I was at trying to debug this. Basically, the last thing that I did before kind of starting to prep for the stream was to implement a tracer for this. So if I run this with some more options, I can actually get a full-on instruction trace of what's going on. I'm going to switch to cargo because I don't actually know if the installed version has that feature. If I run the version out of this current tree, -l trace. So this makes a small change. The ptrace runtime is now doing a single step instead of a continue every time it tries to go back into the sandboxed binary. And it's giving me a ton of output for that. So this will be a trace of all the instruction pointers. Gosh, that is pretty interesting, right? It goes right from one whatever DB40 to just DB46. Almost like this is part of, I don't know what to call this piece. I keep wanting to call it the dynamic linker, but this is we're getting into areas of Linux where I'm kind of fuzzy on. Like, I don't actually know how relocations are processed in a statically linked position independent binary on Linux, which is, I think, the case we're getting. So this, if I understand correctly, this binary has no interpreter set. So it's not actually a dynamically loaded or dynamically linked binary, but it has the like etdyne elf flag. So it's actually asking the kernel to position it randomly still. So my guess here is that there's something I'm filling out incorrectly in the elf header, so that my theory is that there is some like stub dynamic linker that is linked into the binary, which is responsible for handling the relocations in the absence of the full-on like interp elf interpreter. But I don't actually know if that's the case. I don't really know how this part of libc works, so I'm figuring it out as I go. But I'm kind of curious just like what's at that address, because I haven't looked at this exact crash before. I've been looking at this binary crashing on like echo hello world, which I think is a slightly different crash. But I haven't really looked at the shell crash recently. So many instructions. I should be writing this to a file, huh? This is a different IP address, but a similar phenomenon where it seems like we've got some pointers to an address which is similar to this, but with the relocation applied. And yeah, same pattern here. So like, what is that? I'm guessing this is something dynamic linker related, but that's about all I got at the moment. Where? 17260. Oh, show me the addresses. That's not even a real address. Is this the right binary? This is not the right binary. Okay, that explains why this doesn't look like anything in there. That's right. I am running the right image, but not the right binary within that image. I think this image has busybox. Oh no, this is an Alpine image. So I think echo here is actually just the normal shell echo. I actually want like, what is it? User source busybox, busybox unstripped. Yeah, that's the binary I actually have loaded in the disassembler. I'm still going to double check this though. Okay, so that was that CD1BA is definitely a crash I was looking at, so yeah, I think I've already been looking at this one. I think this is the one where it's following a pointer in the heap with a bad value. We can look at this again, but if I remember right, this is an address inside part of malloc, and this is the pointer it's dereferencing. And it's, I think this was a linked list pointer from the heap. So somebody at some point put some memory on the heap, which is outside of our actual mapped address space. I don't know exactly when that happened, but it could have been during initialization. Somebody had a bad idea of where the heap actually goes. There are a couple of places where the libc actually... So there are multiple ways the heap can get initialized. Like when you ask for more heap space at runtime, there's a system call called brk or break, which adjusts the end of the data segment and allocates more memory. We are doing that, and I was pretty sure that this was just like a bug in break, and then I found a bug in break and I fixed it, and this was still happening. So there was a bug in break, but I think this is actually something different. So I think it's using break to allocate some memory, and that might be succeeding, but there might also be another region of memory that's getting thrown in the heap with the wrong address. This is on muscle libc, and just from like looking through the muscle libc source code, there are some places where it tries to take memory regions that would normally be dead spots around shared libraries and like donate those back to the heap. So we could be doing something like that. One of the things I was going to try doing is to look, you know, to make a catalog of those locations where we set up the heap and then like search for those in this dump of addresses to see which of those code paths we actually are taking. I don't know if I have the energy to do that right now, though. This was sort of an annoying path to go down, and I don't feel like it was super fruitful. So I'm actually kind of curious if we could just try the shell and get a slightly different crash, and if that one might be a little bit more illuminating. So this is the same binary, but I'm just trying to run busybox with no arguments, which I think will run the shell in this configuration. This might just give us the help screen, though, which I think will not crash. Oh, I should really be logging this to a file. This is also prompting me to think about performance, but of course, like, normally this does not trace every single instruction. That's only enabled when I have this particular mode on. Okay, that did just print the help and it worked correctly. So we got an instruction trace of it printing the help correctly. Let's do something better. Let's try actually running the shell. Is that just sh here? I thought the shell was called like dash, or maybe that's something else. They have ash. A shell. There is just an sh though. I think those might be the same. Let's see where that crashes. I mean, I fully expect it to crash. Maybe it won't, but sorry, I'm a little behind on chat. Yeah, there's a question about symbols. I do have symbols for everything that I care about having symbols for. So like, I mean, there's plenty of debug support for Rust. Like the problem, the problems I'm running into are not unique to Rust. Like the reason this is difficult to debug is because it's a ptrace system call emulator, not really because of the language that it's written in or anything else. I've got symbols. I could have more tooling for like automatically annotating stuff for sure, but like I have binaries with symbols. And then Chris is wondering if I meant S break instead of break. Those are related. The S break I think is only at the standard library level. The kernel call is break, but they both share a man page. This is one of those cases where there are a lot of cases like this where the system call interface and the libc interface for the same functionality are similar but not identical. So like the kernel break, I can show you what that looks like. I should actually label all my system calls with something other than numbers, but I haven't bothered setting up a table for that. Let's just remind myself what the number is here. Yeah, 12. So yeah, all these emulated sys12s are the breaks. So this first one with an argument of 0 is the C library just determining where the program break is. Is this returning 0? I don't know if I'm reading this right, but if this is actually returning 0 on the first call, that is not correct. There's like one set of escaping for cargo and then another set of escaping for the bandsocks parameter. Yeah, that's interesting. This was not doing this last time I looked at it. It's not supposed to return 0. Trying to determine if this is new or not. I think I need a separate command line option for the instruction trace thing. This was originally just supposed to be a log level, and then I kind of overloaded it so that when it's set to trace, it also runs the single step, and I think that's a little too intense for everyday use. Yeah, maybe I keep trading one type of malloc failure for a different kind of malloc failure. So I don't know why this is returning 0, but normally what happens with this is that the C library calls the sysbreak once with an argument of zero to figure out what the current system break is set to, or the current program break value is set to. So when this is called with zero, this is supposed to return the current value, but it's returning zero, which should never be right. And then I think it's never getting around to calling it again because the C library is just giving up because that's obviously wrong. I don't know when this started, but that's definitely not correct. Maybe we can take a closer look at that. So here's the break implementation. Yeah, so if the new break parameter is zero, we should skip all this and return the existing break. Why don't we? Yeah, I feel like I keep going back and forth between trying to like spend time making debugging less bad and spending time just trying to make the program work. And maybe it's time to spend more time making debugging less bad. Because I don't have a super easy way to do like printf debugging right now. I used to have an easy way to do printf debugging, and then I actually made a pass on trying to like keep my file descriptors from leaking all over the place. Like I actually like separated the standard IO in the container from the standard IO outside the container thoroughly. So I still have a socket connected to standard error on this process, and I can collect the output like on panic, but it's not normally connected to the real standard error. So I might want like a debug flag that overrides that. Marilyn is asking if execve covers that. You mean like the relocation stuff I was talking about earlier? I've certainly been referring to the Linux source code a lot, trying to make this work. And yeah, reading the exec code in Linux is a great way to see exactly how processes are set up. I could be missing something. I did not see that doing relocations, so I'm guessing that's either done by this binary in some way that is currently broken, or something else I'm missing. Yeah, I think it's easy to get confused about what's going on here. So the muscle libc thing, that's just the binary that I'm running. That's like the version of BusyBox I'm debugging. This library, so like the container itself, bansox, that's intended to work with like whatever libc you have handy. I haven't tried compiling it with muscle, but it should work. I mean, the higher level parts of it use the regular Rust standard library, and the lower level parts of it don't use any standard library, so we're kind of just like avoiding serious libc dependencies, hopefully. Marilyn, are you talking about the dynamic linker? LD.so is the dynamic linker. So it's not like magic. It's just part of how ELF binaries are loaded. And like the name is not magic either. The name actually comes from the interpreter section in the ELF binary. So in fact, like if you take a normal program on here, like a shell, and you read ELF, so this is all the headers from that, and this interp section, and this interp program header should be the name of that ld.so binary. And in fact, it's telling us right here that that's specifically lib64 ldlinux x86-64.so.2. So the kernel reads this section, loads this binary, gives it a couple of special arguments that give it information about what program you're using this to run, and then this does most of the work. So that's fine. Like, I feel like I understand roughly how this is supposed to work. I just haven't implemented it yet. The binary that we've been that I've been running just a couple times here, though, is not actually, it doesn't actually point to an ld.so. So it's position independent, but it doesn't use a separate interpreter, which means either something's going on that I'm missing, or it's got some kind of very basic interpreter that's statically linked with it. So that would be like, in this parts directory that we were in earlier. So yeah, I think this is the program where that I've been trying to run. So this shows up as a shared object file. It's not actually a shared object. This is just what ELF calls something that is not statically linked. Like normally this is either exec or dyn, and exec means the kernel doesn't do any relocation or linking or anything. It's loaded at exactly the specified address. My understanding is that dyn is telling the kernel to load this at a dynamic address. So everything here starts at zero. This will not actually work if you load it at zero. You have to choose a non-zero address. So the kernel normally chooses this randomly. You want to randomly set most addresses when you can, just to make it harder for malicious code to guess addresses that it needs in order to run an exploit. So I'm already doing that with the stack and the heap. So my break starts with a randomized value. My stack is at a randomized location, but I haven't actually done that for this yet. It's also worth noting the distinction between section headers and program headers. Things have gotten maybe a little complicated over ELF's lifetime, but like really the goal here is that the program headers are used by the loader and the section headers are used by the linker, and those two things are separate. The dynamic linker does need to use the sections, but my understanding currently, maybe this is not accurate, but my understanding is that the kernel does not actually need the section headers normally. I think there's some code that uses these for like core dumping purposes and for like relocating kernel modules, but for loading a regular binary, my understanding of the process is that it goes through the program headers, all of these load sections turn into mmaps, and then the rest of these are basically ignored by the kernel. This dynamic section is used by the dynamic linker, but this is actually, I think this is actually inside of there. So if you look at this virtual address, it starts at here plus 5,000 hex. So like this is inside of that. This is an important address for the dynamic linker, but I don't think the kernel actually has to know about it. And this is the inside of that dynamic section. So I don't know, maybe there's some relocation here that I'm missing. This is the actual relocation table. I don't know who is supposed to process this in this particular case. My working assumption is that there's some part of the binary's loader that's doing that, but you know, that's probably wrong. Oh yeah, Marlin is asking if there's a thing where you can define custom handlers for what executes a file, like what handles the like sharp bang at the top of scripts. Yeah, so like Linux as a, like the kernel Linux has a whole system for trying to detect what format a binary is and then running it. So there's this data structure called BPRM, which I think is short for binary parameters. And during exec, there's a buffer in there that gets filled with some data from the very beginning of the file. I think it's like 4 kilobytes or 512 bytes or something like that, some round number. And that buffer gets passed around to a bunch of modules that can do a detection phase and say, this might be something I can load or this might not be something I can load. So like for shells, or for the, you know, like shell scripts, there's a detector which looks at that like sharp bang line, and passes control to a separate program if it finds one. There's also a way to register these handlers in user space. Like, for a while, there was this thing where people thought it would be cool if Linux could just run Java binaries directly. So, you know, there's support for some stuff like that. Yeah, the bin format, there are a lot of weird formats that the kernel can support other than ELF. I mean, people probably disable them when they're security conscious, but it'd be interesting. I haven't like really looked through the kernel configuration in Ubuntu in a while. I was actually kind of surprised to see that vsyscall stuff in there. That vsyscall section from that we were looking at earlier is actually not turned on by default. It's like an emulation of a deprecated feature. And Ubuntu has it, but a lot of kernels don't. I left my standard error somewhere else. Anyway, I feel like this is maybe coming up on a good time to wrap this up. It's a little bit late for me to just like completely dive into the total depths of debugging this, but I feel like it was good to kind of at least give a bit of a status update on this project, intermixed with our other kind of higher level discussion there. Oh yeah, Marlin found the bin format script, which is indeed the one for shebang lines. Yeah, I'm gonna have to support that. Like basically, like everything in bin format is something I can't get at from inside of my sandbox, so I have to implement that in the sand process. So like I've even got like a placeholder for that functionality. I went ahead and made like a whole directory for my bin format stuff, even though right now it's mostly just ELF64. But I have a stub for this script, which currently doesn't do anything. I'm using this funny library that it's got a picture that makes me laugh every time I open it. Wasn't this from was this the Dark Crystal? Anyway, some movie I've probably seen once. So yeah, I'm using a little Rust library to parse the ELF bits. It's not even like doing any parsing really. It's mostly just like definitions of the structures that I need. Yeah. To do, calculate a location. Init registers. I mean, the kernel's job in loading a binary is thankfully not super complicated. I'm just doing something wrong and I need to figure out what that is. But yeah, luckily the dynamic linker does most of the work. Oh, Labyrinth. Oh, Labyrinth, yes. Gosh, I should watch that again. It's been too long. Yes, why was I getting Labyrinth and the Dark Crystal confused? Those are both movies that are good that I have not seen more than like once, so I should probably fix that and refresh my memory on all the Muppets. Yeah, this is a whole like no standard wonderland here. Let's go to crates. So most of this stuff I've been doing is under the Bansox crate. But like a lot of the dependencies here don't actually show up under here. Since this project is really split into sort of two separate binaries, so this outer crate becomes part of the program you're compiling this into. So in my video server, this will just be a Rust library that's linked into the video server and becomes part of its mostly static binary. but there's a little chunk of code that this compiles separately and then just includes. This is definitely an area where I feel like I'm misusing cargo in Rust. It's like this is a nested Rust build where I'm compiling a separate binary from inside of my build.rs for a Rust library. So this gets compiled as just like a little 250 kilobyte binary on its own. And then this, along with its protocol exports, get built in as part of the Bansox binary or part of its library. This does not really have a public interface. It's like main argv. But I've got some okay docs for the higher level parts. I mean, they still need work, but I've at least started on them. So yeah, if you need something that can make BusyBox crash while downloading binaries from the internet, I've got a library for it. Doesn't really do the intended goal though. Oh, that's a good question. Spoofed Existence is asking if Rust helps reducing dependence on big tech, and if so, why? Well, I mean, not directly. I mean, there's a whole set of things we're doing here. So, at the very highest level, technology is being used for a lot of things that are not really humane and don't help individual people like accomplish things, but are really just in the service of kind of keeping us entrapped in this system that produces value for the monopolies. And so there's maybe like a human element to trying to get out of that system. And so we were talking about that a bunch earlier on the stream. There also just seems to be room for just making the tools for actually hosting your own content and like weaning yourself off of the large providers. Like, you know, there's a lot of room for improvement in those tools. So one of those little areas that I've been trying to help on is to make a video server that can be part of a decentralizable video service that's kind of like a PeerTube thing. But you know, my friend Z and I, who was on here a little earlier, we're interested in trying to build the like technical and social tools to help with this. So we've been exploring both of those angles. And so, yeah, Rust, I mean, it's just a tool, right? But in this case, it's a tool that might help us make some video server bits that are useful for helping actually provide a way to build communities rather than just like a way to be like stuck inside of the monopoly. But yeah, it's not like building some code, you know, writing some code or building some program is going to actually like help people directly. It's like, we need to approach this from both sides simultaneously, like try to figure out what are the actual like human factors here? And then also like, what are the tech nails that we can hit with our tech hammer? So yeah, the Rust stuff is just a tech hammer, but it seemed like a useful thing for this and, you know, trying to get a video server out of it in the end. I guess more broadly though, like, you know, anything that you do that, that lets you kind of open the hood on the things that you use is a step in the right direction. But like just opening the hood, like if everyone didn't have the ability to just drive their car, people wouldn't use the cars either. I mean, cars are, maybe cars are a good example. They're noxious and they're messing up the environment, but people rely on them for their day-to-day life, much like other technological objects. But yeah, there's a lot there. I feel like I'm a little bit running out of steam for this particular stream, so I should probably wrap this up and sign off for the night. But it's been interesting kind of poking around on the tech bits with folks, and it was great having some conversation about the like higher level parts of this. Love to keep that up. I know Z and I are up for doing more of these kind of streams and doing more solo stuff and joint stuff. And thanks so much to all my patrons and everybody who stops by and hangs out with the stream. This is 100% viewer funded. So if you like what we're doing and you want to chip in a dollar or two a month to help kind of keep paying the electric bill and keeping the servers online, I've got a Patreon at patreon.com/scanlime. But, you know, this is 2020. Everybody's having a hard time. So, like, you know, don't stress out if that's not in the cards. And there are plenty of other ways to support. Like, just if you want to participate in this conversation that we've been having about reducing your dependency on big tech, this is the place to go. We set up a little survey and some more, Z has tons of links that they put in here and a lot of information. And then if you just want to give us a couple of words on like what your priorities and interests are, we can try to take those into account in the next streams that we do. And just trying to like make some of these connections between the human needs and the technology needs here in the context of technology that actually works and isn't vaporware. That feels like a good thing to do. Trains. Yes, trains rights. Oh yeah, Rust is... I would say that Rust is a pretty good tool for some of these things, like making a video server and making a sandbox. Those seem pretty good. Also, I feel like personally, this is not like a reason anyone else should care, but like personally, I like that Rust is fun to use and has a decent community around it for the most part. Like, that makes me hate computers less. So it's easier for me to be less burned out about coding if I'm coding in a language that isn't terrible. So that's kind of nice, but certainly I wouldn't make that the only reason, but it's a good reason. Yeah, re-decentralize the internet, reduce our dependence on big tech. Yeah, that feels like something that we need to do in order to make this place that so many of us live in feel livable again. And it is a struggle for power, for sure. Like, this is never just technology. This is always humans interacting and fighting for power, which means it's always political. It always involves context, which is much bigger than the actual tools. Well, I will see everyone else on the next stream, I hope. If you want to keep up to date on these, there are a few ways to do that. You can follow on the actual video platforms. You can get notifications from twitch.tv/scanlime. You can also go to the YouTube sphere, which doesn't have a nice URL, but if you search for Scanlime in Progress, you can find this and get notifications. I've also got a bot hanging out on Twitter that you can follow to get periodic screenshots and notifications of these streams when they're actually going. So yeah, it's not very high traffic, but it gives you one tweet when the streams are starting, and then just like usually a couple of tweets per stream, like, you know, once every like hour and a half or so, probably. It gives you a little screenshot. So that's kind of nice if you want to keep up with these. Well, I'm going to go get a bite to eat and play with Tuco, but happy hacking, everyone. I will see you on the next stream.